All right, guys, welcome back. This is Let's Hash It Out, episode 41, I believe. It's hard to believe, been 41 weeks of a show, but we've made it, and we want to welcome you and hope you stick around. So, oh no.
Hi.
Some things in life are bad. They can really make you mad. Other things just make you swear and curse. When you're chewing on life's gristle, that grumble, give a whistle. And this'll help things turn out for the best. And always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the light side of life. If life seems jolly rotten, there's something you've forgotten, and that's to laugh and smile and dance and sing. When you're feeling in the dumps, don't be silly chumps, just purse your lips and whistle, that's the thing. Hey,
always look on the bright side of life.
Come on.
Always look on the bright side of life.
For life is quite absurd, and death's the final word. You must always face the curtain with a bow. Forget about your scene, give the audience a grin. Enjoy it, it's your last chance anyhow.
So always look on the bright side of death. Just before you draw your terminal breath.
Life's a piece of shit when you look at it. Life's a laugh and death's a joke, it's true. You'll see it's all a show, keep them laughing as you go. Just remember that the last laugh is on you. And
always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the right side of life.
Come on, Brian, cheer up.
Always look on the right side of life. Always look on the right side of life.
Those things happen to see, you know.
Always look on the right side.
You know, you come from nothing, you're going back to nothing. What you lost?
Always
nothing!
Look on the right side of life.
Nothing will come from nothing, you know what I say?
Always
cheer up, you old bugger. Come on, give us a quiz. There you are. See? In the film. Incidentally, this record's available
always
in the foyer.
Always look on the right.
Some of us want to live as well, you know. Alright, it's a lot. Let's get this place up there.
I'll never make that money back. All right, guys, I'm coming. Let me unmute y'all. Let's see. So welcome back, everyone. Let's hash it out. Episode 41. I'm trying to unmute everyone, but I don't know. Maybe you have to do it.
Hi.
Hi.
All right. I'm good.
Hi. It almost didn't sound right.
Hi.
So anyway, you know, who knew that the Ides of March would extend into April? But whatever.
Happens.
Yeah. It sometimes it's brute. All right.
Definitely.
So anyway, what y'all got going on? I've got mining going on. I've been, you know, I do another show here and there. Mining Shed Adventures. Now I've got the S19J Pro built out. I'm ready to go hang it up in the shed. Pimping I mean, it wall mounts and everything, but you know, I got to duct it out of the building, and then I've got to do a AC Infinity exhaust fan. So it's quite a bit I got yet to do before it's operational, just in time for the halving of Bitcoin. And Bitcoin Cash was a few days ago last week. So anyway, why, welcome back. It's good, y'all.
Why, Dave? Why? According to a Spaces show I listened to last night, hash has nothing to do with where we're going or what we're doing.
Hash is fundamental to blockchain. Yeah. So it has a lot to do with it.
Exactly. Not just the blockchain. I also like to smoke it.
Yeah.
Yes. Hash it out.
Exactly. No, I heard that last night. I found it interesting.
Really? Well, if you have no hash, though, you have no blockchain, right?
Who said that?
According to them.
Were you talking to Fidelity?
That's a common space show that we show up to. And
right.
I don't know. We were talking about it. And
right.
Like,
out of respect, I didn't speak.
Yeah. I just. I missed it. Kind of becoming a listener now. Shocking.
Huh.
Yeah. Well, you know.
It's been the same thing. I did want you to, you said something, Dave, and I wanted you to repeat it about what use case you finally found a use case for Litecoin or
for Lightning Network. Oh. Lightning Network. Yeah. I actually found a good use case where, like, okay, so Lightning Network, you know, I would have to get, you know, my 84-year-old mother and her 86-year-old friends to, you know, each download a node and all this other stuff. But yet, I found a good use case for it in that, you know, going through all the mining and everything. Well, I was digging around on NiceHash. And if you're mining and you're in the United States, you have to get paid out in Bitcoin. Well, instead of getting a $20 or $30 transaction, you know, just on getting a payout, they can actually on NiceHash use the Lightning Network. So I don't know how long ago they implemented that, but I thought that was actually kind of cool. So it's an actual use case of Lightning Network to receive Bitcoin, because that's the only payout I can receive in the U.S. So, yeah, that just tidbit of info for anyone out there that, you know, that does help the miners a lot. May not be good from, I mean, I don't know. It may be, but it needs to be simple, stupid. So until that point, you know, it's good for those of us and the miners, that kind of stuff.
Well, until then, we got an ETF at least.
Litecoin's doing an ETF.
Oh, I was talking about Bitcoin.
Oh. I heard rumors of Litecoin.
Oh, it'll happen, I'm sure. Why wouldn't it? But whatever. I don't care.
Yeah. Well, isn't everything based on fiat? I've given up. I've given up the fight. I'm like, dude, I fought that for how long? Me and you, Westwood, were like, it's the problem, fiat. The problem. Dude, I'm okay now.
I got that comment in the last stream that I did live. You know, someone was asking me, is Digibyte my largest holding? And, you know, I didn't even think about it. But, you know, are you asking me as far as number of coin, or are you asking me in fiat? I mean, what would be, you know, as far as coin? Yes, it's my largest holding. As far as in fiat, that fluctuates daily. And, you know, but my response to the person was that even though I swing trade and I do different things, I take that profit and I do put it into Digibyte. And albeit at 1.5 cents right now, no, it's not my largest holding. I hope for it to one day be. But I've got a few trades still out there on the books. And I got a few other things I want I want those other projects to do well this cycle, then take profit, and then to buy back into Digibyte a larger position. So, because I see other things. I to me, it makes more sense as far as the future of blockchain innovation. So, yeah, that's my long-term play is Digibyte. That's why the logo's up there in the corner.
Yeah, I guess that's a good topic because, I mean, you know, if somebody asks you that question, what's your largest holding? Well, it kind of depends. I mean, what have you put the most energy into? That's the way I look at it because, I mean, you might have put a lot into a certain coin, but it hasn't like, well, look at Bitcoin this year. So, you know, you put it in something else and Bitcoin went up. So in dollar price, what you held in Bitcoin might be more than what you put into this coin, but you really didn't work too hard at it because you had a little bit and it went up really high. But, you know, this coin didn't move, but you put a lot of energy in this little coin, you know, because you believe in it long term and that's what you want to use. So it's hard to do the whole dollar thing because, you know, you'll get a coin that pumps and doubles overnight and it's like, oh, well, I guess that's my largest holding now, even though that's not the one I really put my energy and faith into as much. I just have some. But, you know, I guess what you're saying, Dave, and that's kind of, it's kind of, I don't want to say it's your unit of account, but it's almost like it's your long-term, you know, thing that, like you said, you know, if you do well in other coins, you know, my go-to is Digibyte, you know, if that's the case, you know, like me, it's like my go-to is Litecoin. If I did well in something else, that's the one I feel most confident in. And as long as it's not four digits yet, and it's only three digits, I'm like, yeah, I think I might put it in that. That's a bargain, you know, and plus I believe in it long-term. So, you know, that's kind of my thing. And Digibyte. I like Digibyte too, though.
Yeah. Now, I did see something where, you know, after the halving, someone, I think in a Litecoin community, actually did an interview with the founder of Bitcoin Cash, Roger Ver. Well, that was one of my thoughts as well. But, you know, I kind of wanted to have a discussion on the impact of SHA-256 halving and the mining migration. You know, I wanted to have that discussion with someone else. And, you know, someone else had also made a comment on a recommendation by someone. And, you know, part of me does kind of agree that that if I were to interview Jared, that this stage here would be different than a one-on-one interview. Oh, yeah. or yeah, sure. Debate or. Actually, sure. not really a debate. I mean, it's more of a discussion on the importance of hash and what happens with the hash rate and what happens when it's no longer profitable. Then what?
Well, it gives y'all an opportunity to be brutally honest.
You know, we joke around here a little bit. I mean, you know, so it's a different vibe. You know, if it's a one-on-one thing, you know, maybe it wouldn't be such a brutal conversation. It's not like it's that way now, but, you know. I mean, I could see some people thinking that, you know, you got four guys coming at you. Holy cow. You know.
Well, I mean, I'm just saying as far as rapid fire questions, like mm-hmm, if sure. The man was in the middle of giving a dissertation or something, sort of say, and then to be interrupted constantly. I mean, I know that we go through this every week. We've kind of become accustomed to it. For anyone listening, there is, if you decide that you want to do a YouTube channel and all, which I do, I will gladly help you and point you in the right directions as far as which softwares and all that I use in order to do these different things. But just know there is also like a 1.25 second delay between what you say and what you hear. So it becomes a little difficult sometimes.
Really, really difficult. Some of us. No, understand. No, and well, I just see the value, Dave, of you being. I always have seen you as probably the less emotional of the group, and actually a very, very emotionless person in your speaking. You're not excited. Stick to the topic, and
I just call it the way I see it.
Exactly. So I would love to see that. I mean. I would definitely have comments on Thursday, but you know what? Yeah, to bring someone in here for a gangbang, in my what would seem to be, and it's not. I have, look, as everybody knows, I'm in it for the tech, but as much as I know about the tech, but I'm in it for bettering my life. Hell, we've got the Southwood. Now we have the real Southwood, which is souther than down here. I'm definitely, I think I'm keeping this place down
to the
here.
To the person, to the chat room, Crypto John. Yeah, actually, yes. He's saying he bought two miners, Avalon Nano, and, you know, good choice. Yeah, the SHA-256, if you want to solo mine that, there's a good solo tutorial on the Discord. So go to Digibyte Discord, and there's a good tutorial there on how to solo mine Digibyte with SHA-256. So go take a look at that. So anyway, what's good, Steak? You've been a little quiet today, man. What's good?
You fall down?
Oh, no, I'm just smoking a little bit, and I'm just wondering if someone would ask me what my biggest holding was, I would probably reply, your mother.
Set up that!
Yep.
Well, there it is. I mean,
yep.
You know, I don't understand. Really,
you're a brute. I'm just saying.
I don't have a lot to add to that. You know, I don't see Jarrett Tate. I don't see Jarrett Tate as Julius Caesar, but, you know, to each their own. It is what it is, you know. Yeah. And I would definitely ask him questions.
I don't know.
I like some transparency on some things, but apparently just having curiosity with important questions on important topics kind of already makes you annoying. I mean, no one is hated more than the guy that speaks the truth, right? So it's just
I mean,
honestly, sometimes when you cross the Rubicon, there's no coming back. So, you know, sometimes people just don't want to go there.
Yeah. And you know what? That's true. And sometimes you have to put it this way. Sometimes it's not about being liked. It's always been about character. Even when I put my foot in it and I've got to pay the consequences. You answer the question, you get over it. Charlie Lee did. He's answered the questions on why he sold, when he sold, where he sold, you know, how much his mama weighs and all the other fucking questions they asked him. Dude, you go on. And it's always going to come up, but I've already answered those questions. You know, in Steak's behalf, there's been almost a 2-year silence. And maybe there was a lot going on behind there, but there's been a lot going on. I know, Steak, you were talking about, you posted something about Rudy, and I just read through this. It took me forever to make my screen turn to the side.
What do you mean posted about Rudy? I said, welcome back to Rudy.
Welcome back, and so just wanted to know something about that.
He really tweeted again after in November, I think last year, he tweeted that he left Twitter. He had his reasons. And he also left DigiCorp Labs. I think his reasons were private. But, you know, that happens. And then he said, I'm going to leave Twitter. And now he tweeted today that his first tweet in half a year. So I guess he might be back. I don't know. So I thought that would be interesting because he's always been a very prolific figure in the Digibyte community. And he is one of the founders of DigiCorp Labs. So, yeah, it makes sense that you... Yeah, I mean...
And sometimes there's a coincidence factor that there's a lot of interest in Digibyte with some of the, old people... older than us, I was in it on the ICO, but some of the real old people in it. I mean, does it feel like to anybody else that there's a lot of interest? More interest that has been going on.
Well, you mean the 2017 ICOs, because Digibyte did an ICO.
Right? Yeah. That's when I got in. I didn't even know what it did. And then I've learned about it some more. But right now, coincidentally, and it just doubled. It's still shit. It's at a half penny. It went back down, but it hit 2 cents. I don't know. It's Josiah. Josiah coming back on the show, or are we going to start getting some of the oldies coming? I'm starting to hear the old names that I once heard.
Roger Vitter. He's back.
There you go.
I would like to reach out to other people like, Script Skynet as well as Blazard. I would love to interview Blazard just on the NFT portion and what all his involvement was, and then moving over to another chain and, you know, what he thinks on some of this. So,
well, I think we should. I mean, we are actually investors that are truly interested in not just, even though we are interested in the money going up and the price going up, it's in fiat, and we'll take that to take care of some of our immediate bills or challenges that we have. But I want to go back. Let's go back to the old days. What went on then? What do they feel that the difference is now? I would absolutely welcome any more knowledge that we could possibly get on this coin and token and any other token that we've mentioned. I mean, why not? Is it the information that we're seeking?
Just curious if we're still talking about decentralized money, you know, and all the OGs, you know, if they come back, you know, does it still look the same to them, or does it look different? What's the landscape look like now?
No, we're talking about brute cologne. That cologne you used to
wear. Oh, brute. Brute.
See, I was thinking more like the garbage can, you know, to take the trash out. You know, brute.
Oh.
But
I think I'll be strong to do that too.
Why are you gonna say that, Pauly P?
Brutus Beefcake. Remember at WWE, Brutus Beefcake. Remember him? I just watched the video, Dark Side of the Ring, on him. Oh, the far Brutus the Barber Beefcake right there.
Send you 100,000 digibyte, and I'll send you 1,000,000 doggy bite. Okay.
I got to see how I got to get a QR code in there, and then, you know, give a little speech where my lips don't match the words, you know, that come out of my mouth.
Yeah, Pauly, I was going to mention to Pauly that I saw a picture of him with a big old Colgate smile, and you look good, brother. You look.
It was a Colgate smile, wasn't it?
That one was called a Colgate smile.
Are you looking good?
All grinning ear to ear. He looked pretty.
You're looking good. Like a new man.
Okay.
You gotta love it.
Got
it, warrior.
Gotta call it like it is.
Yeah. I don't know. We've got interest rates. We can talk about interest rates not going down anytime soon here in the U.S. I mean, it looks like that's off the table for the time being. Yeah.
Well, that makes it real easy to push back people that have house loans, maybe 10 years left. We just move it back to 30 years so they can keep the same price.
Man.
Excuse me. I'll be right back. I've got to get my glucometer. I need to test myself. I got all started and everything. Didn't even have everything ready. Sorry. I'll be right back.
All right, man. Check yourself before you wreck yourself.
Yeah. Look what you did, Westwood.
Look what you made me do.
Yeah. What you put them all through do. High blood pressure and shit.
Man. No, man.
You know, I'm seeing that, Westwood. And, we're kind of like-minded in most ways. Yeah. You just understand it a lot better. And I guess we're still running through this frustration. There's a big thing that I'm feeling, and it's frustrating to me because we've broken away from what I came into crypto for. Now, I'll be honest, I'm kind of in it for the money. Pay off this, go into another S. I don't know. Is that because I don't have the faith in crypto like I did 17 when I was ready to change the world? And this is what it's going to be. The world's going to be better, and kumbaya, we're going to sing hand in hand. Now, is it just, sometimes I hear it from you, or maybe I think I hear it from you, but it's like, it's not that we gave up. It's just that No one's listening. I hear your frustration, and when you're ranting, it's because you're like, you don't use the words that I would. You stupid, and look, you're not listening. You're not freaking listening.
Right.
Stay your ass safe. Look, this is the game.
Yeah. I mean, I think we all feel it, you know, and that's what happens in different parts of the cycle. You see, we were talking about OGs coming back, and I mean, and you know, you had some of these people who are very fervent, let's say, with their message and very forceful and like, hey, you got an opportunity here, let's use it. You know, you got decentralized money, let's use it. And at some point, it gets a little frustrating, I guess, and you're just, it's kind of worn out just because it's like, man, is nobody listening? Is nobody doing anything? And then when you got a Bitcoin ETF and that's the biggest thing ever and everybody loves it, you think, well, that's like the antithesis of what we got into it for. You know, yes, now.
Go ahead. It's not about financial freedom anymore.
No, exactly.
It's just, it's pumping our bags and getting them up there and let's get our, it's what, I mean, I hear it. And I don't blame it. You know, hey, Westwood, all of us have bills. You've got bills. I got bills. I hear you crying.
Absolutely.
Hey, I got a daughter in college. I've got a, you know, and thank God they do accept crypto over there. But some of the other stuff isn't, you know, I hear Dave trying to finish up. Now that I've decided to keep this place, I'm going to start that journey that Dave's going through and, you know, getting it up to my standard. There's nothing wrong with the placement, working on it. And I'm like, oh man, I've heard Dave. I've heard what Dave's gone through. I've heard the nightmares. And I'm in the deep South where it should be really readily available, all the worker and people. But it's still a problem when you got people at McDonald's making $20 an hour.
Yeah, and Warrior's saying that gold and silver. Gold is at an all-time high, and then silver is almost $29. I mean, silver, I don't know. Silver's got to go up a bit for me. Gold, I mean, I'm way in profit in gold. Uh-huh. So I listen to all and follow none on gold.
Yeah, but you know what? According to the printing, and I don't want to be the guy that's always shitting on the world currency, but according to that, how much we printed, are we really gone up? And I'm happy that it's gone up this much. Is it because they, and you would probably be able to answer it, Westwood, is it because they have no choice? It's because people are already running 8% interest coming up. Our money, you need $20 to go buy a hamburger, $80 for a family of four to go to eat at McDonald's. Is it people?
Yeah, I think you're seeing less. You're seeing the signs of it. And, you know, gold's making all-time highs, and it's not really that big a news. You know what I mean? It's not like, oh, my gosh, you know, the system's collapsing. I mean, I don't even think we're even close to that moment yet to where that stuff, when it goes, it's going to go big. I mean, the metals will go big, and any flight to safety is going to go big. But I don't think we're there yet. But I think there's a lot of signs that are showing that it's starting to unwind. I think, Stake, you posted something about the Japanese yen. And somebody did a little bit of a mild dissertation, I guess, as far as.
Uh-oh. Wait.
Damn that, Westwood. Right. When
yeah, he was speaking too much facts, so he got removed.
Yeah. Quit talking too much facts, Westwood.
Yeah, I guess.
Speaking code.
Yeah, right. But yeah, I mean those things. I mean there are mal investments, I guess you could say. There are problems in the economy, and the dollar's created a lot of them. And how's that unwind itself? I guess because it's going to have to at some point.
The dollar created all of them. The dollar created all of them.
No, I agree. I mean the dollar's the problem.
I can hear myself double. By the way, does anyone have an echo?
Really?
Yeah, I hear an echo too.
Okay, maybe it's
Westwood.
Maybe this is picking up on my mic. Hang on, let me lower it.
Maybe the guy listening to you, Westwood. Is
there. How's that? That better? I won't talk so loud. I'll be nice and soft.
Yeah, gentle.
Yeah.
Talk to me about the yen a little bit more.
Caress.
I can still hear an echo.
Really?
Yeah.
Wait, let me mute.
Maybe it
wasn't.
Is that it?
All right, no, still an echo. Dead. Is it me? I'm going to mute. All right, I'm out.
Well, okay. No, I don't hear it. Yeah, it was Westwood. It was you. Right. You. Yeah, you.
We'd still like to talk to you, though, Clint.
Yeah. Do you do it in sign language?
Yeah, so gold right now is at $2,384. Silver is at $28.65. Platinum to me seems like the better deal for me. I mean, palladium is still out of this world at 1,082. Good question. I don't know. Copper.
It's a little over $4, like $4.30 last time I looked, a pound.
$4 doing well.
30 cents. Yeah, that's up.
Well, what's oil? I'm going to tell you, I found diesel here for $3, South Texas.
Really?
They brought in a pipeline right here to the – that's why I decided not to sell to the port of Brownsville. Absolutely, I've never seen so much construction on one side. And it's not on the island, but it's right before you get to the island. So you got LP gas, of course. You had the, what is that called, the Eagle Shale in here in South Texas. I just see too much movement, and if you want to live somewhere nice, you got to live up to the island. Everything. I'm not saying that there's not places in South Texas like Brownsville, and but it's there's really not much to do. It's not a metropolitan city, so yeah.
Gee whiz, copper is at $4.28.
Oh, yeah, that's been a big move.
A pound.
Yep. Yep, yep. What are those nickels worth now? Are they worth 6 cents yet?
Yeah, those pennies.
That's another good one.
Well, actually, the nickel at one time was worth 10 cents.
I know, because the nickel price was way up, and copper was up too, but the nickel drove it up pretty high.
Y'all are ignoring the elephant, the pen. The old pennies.
The elephant.
Got
to
be.
I know.
Yeah. Got to be.
The elephant is in the room. Yeah, your 1982, pre-1982, and some 1982 pennies. 2.8 cents each, baby. 2.8 times. If you can sort through those babies in your change. Yeah, the nickel's worth 5.75 cents. So every nickel that you get out of your change.
When you talk about like things changing in the economy, wasn't it Costco that is selling gold now? To its customers.
And silver.
I mean,
gold and silver.
That is not normal market behavior.
Well, nope. And they sell out quite a bit.
Yep, they do.
And so, what's that say?
People want it. It basically says that Costco thinks that it's good to do business in rare metals.
And it wasn't.
Which is kind of. Sure.
Sorry, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
No,
it's all right. No worries. Go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say that there wasn't as – it was a reasonable premium at the Costco on those.
Really? So they're making metals. Good amount of money.
Well, it's just reasonable. It's not like silver where they were $10, one-third, two-thirds, half of a – so that's what I had heard. I have never bought at Costco any gold or silver.
Yeah, I mean, they'll be pretty reasonable. I haven't looked at the price, but they're always pretty good on it because they want volume. They want to move the stuff, and they've been moving it. And it tells me that retail really does, that, you know, it opens up a whole avenue to the precious metals
It's just weird as fuck. Costco selling gold.
I know, nuts.
Who's allowing
I look at it from, like, the aspect that basically the market is so fucked right now that this is happening. That's the angle that I think is interesting. And you mentioned it earlier, Clint, where you were talking about the interest rate, the basis points, the BPS, probably going to increase by 0.5%, 50 basis points by June. And they estimate after the election, another 150, they need to cut rates in order to breathe some life into, you know, the economy. We all know it because they kind of overshot with it. But when you mentioned the yen later on, for those of you listening, Japan, the yen, basically bought a lot of the U.S. debt of the treasuries, And at a certain point, they might not do that and actually start selling them because they want to draw the liquidity away from it So now the money from Japan is going to the U.S., but then the money from the U.S. will go to Japan because you still have to pay your own debt as a country. And the more you print, the more debt you got, the more you have to pay back every single time. And, you know, based on a ratio of debt, that's actually accelerating.
Yep.
So the debt as in proportion of GDP is accelerating so much. Right now, I think it's 34.5, maybe a little bit more trillion, a T.
We're going to 50.
U.S. dollars. Yeah, I think so, too. That's exactly what I wanted to say. Like, there's been estimates that if you look at where it's going, they might be printing. And we're talking about 2025, right? I mean, so between 2020 and 2025, if you look at the increase of money printing and the increase, of course, by that in inflation, then it's just so preposterous. With the cost of living, with what you mentioned with McDonald's or even, you know, getting gas somewhere, it's already like being fucked right now. So what's happening when we print even more? And that's the U.S. I mean, look at other countries that might not be so flexible and diverse in their own economy that the inflation will have more ramifications on a social economical level.
Yeah, they don't have
look at Europe, but it's just weird as fuck.
Yeah, most countries don't have a world reserve currency, right? You know, there's only one, and so you've got the luxury of just creating all you want, but it comes with consequences.
How long will that last? How long will the dollar still be a reserve currency?
Let me make a comment. They're listening to our show. They're getting the cash and buying assets. The problem is they're buying all our assets here in the United States.
Is your boy Jamie?
Inside information, remember? You see that earlier? Can you imagine? Inside information on what the
the consumer price index, the CPI.
Oh, they actually got
from the Bureau of like Statistics or something like that. They actually got it firsthand what the statistics on the economy was. They could front run everything.
See, they're telling us everything that we already decide. Do, and now they're like rolling it out, saying, laughing at us, and saying, "Look what we're doing! Ha! Screw you!"
Yeah. So basically,
that's
another confirmation that government and big banks are just, you know, two peas in a pot.
Yep.
I was surprised to find out we actually have subtitles in Russian. So I thought that was kind of cool. So thanks. I don't know how to say thank you in Russian, but yeah, thanks.
Vodka.
Yeah. I only know Nostrovia.
You know what? You know, people are starting to realize that the hot potato is I don't know. Maybe I should do it in question form. Are people starting to realize that the hot potato is the fiat currency, the world reserve fiat currency?
Honestly,
I'm seeing Saudi Arabia building a new city of leisure. I don't know what the hell they're doing.
Yeah, they've been doing that for a while now. They're actually cutting spending on that, on NAOM, the line. But
the line.
With what you're saying, are people waking up? I don't think people are waking up. I think what people are encountering is that the cost of living is increasing so rapidly and their salary isn't keeping pace. That I think that's the narrative that we hear in society that's waking people up. But still, even if they feel that pain, many of them are just arguing back and forth about what they think is wrong about the world instead of asking the question, how is this happening? And, you know, so people aren't, you know, educating themselves. They're just yapping.
I'll give you a perfect example of this. Yesterday on the local news in the state of Illinois, here in the United States, the governor of Illinois in the budget put $1 million in it. And $1 million, which isn't a lot of money, I know, you know, for the states to be spending, but he's going to spend $1 million to give diapers to daycares in the state of Illinois. So they fill out some paperwork and they get diapers because, you know, it's hard times and people, you know, they can't afford stuff. So you got the government buying diapers now.
That's the definition of a shit coin.
Definitely. That's like Japan does that too, but it's mostly for older people, I think. They got the oldest population wearing diapers, I think, isn't it? Depends. We're headed there. You know, because that's all we're doing, just standing around shatting ourselves. So you know, more diapers.
World
needs more diapers.
I'm so proud of you guys. It's almost socialism. I'm so proud of you guys.
Right. Yeah, yeah. Hey, you need some diapers for the kids? Oh, here, let's just put it in the budget.
This when you watch taxes. The news. You watch the news, you put on a pair of Depends.
Yeah. It's a brutal world, man. You got to wear Depends watching the news.
Exactly. But then you're ready.
But then you can be prepared. You know, double up.
Yeah, for big people like yourself, Westwood, sometimes we need to.
So what does that do with crypto, right? I mean, if we look at what we've just been saying for the last 40 minutes or 35, and like, if you got 50 BPS in June, if you've got Tether being delisted already today on an exchange, but probably it had a letter from the Department of Justice or the Treasury actually department that was linking Tether now not only to, you know, they were linked in December along with FTX to funding ISIS, and now they're allegedly connected to funding Russia. Mm-hmm. Which is kind of a big deal in the current, you know. I'm laughing, but it's kind of like, really? It's like,
we have sanctions for how many years now on Russia? And now there's one funding. What's going to happen?
If there's one thing you shouldn't do to get targeted, I don't know. It's maybe funding Russia. It's like the number one thing on the list you shouldn't do. It's like the number one thing right now. It's like the worst timing ever. Did we really do Russia? Fuck, that's going to bite us in the ass. Fuck it. Just do Russia.
Join the Britain Nation
3 years from now. Fuck it. Who cares? You know, just do it. Everyone does it. Everyone does it. If we don't do it, it's better, then someone else will. You know, just do it. Fuck it. And it's just, that's going to bite him in the ass, but it's going to bite crypto in the ass, too. I mean, if you look at it short term, really short term, like from today till maybe 20th of April, which is like the end of next week. I can see Bitcoin rallying upward. I mean, on the 15th of April, we have the spot ETF in Hong Kong going live. That will have the same effect as we had in January with the rally upwards. Then Grayscale BTC has kind of been sold to BlackRock because we moved out of the reverse part, and all of a sudden we had this trend line upwards on the weekly of Bitcoin. Then you got that. Then on the 16th, you actually have the halving itself probably happening. Could be a little bit later, depends on the block, but probably around that. So that's on Tuesday. So on Monday, we got Hong Kong. On Tuesday, we got the spot dead, the halving on the 16th. Then we got the hash rate moving immediately, probably going to Digibyte as well, like you know, Dave has been saying and showing through evidence. And then, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if we go to 80,000. At the end of next week. Mm-hmm. But if you look at like the 50 basis points in the Tether narrative, like the overall arch in crypto that's happening in June, that could give us a little bit of a retracement back. And I don't think it's going to be a major correction, but it wouldn't surprise me if we go a little bit below 60K, if we go to like 55, 57K, I can see that happening. Mm-hmm. And then maybe after that, we can get a summer holiday to like, I don't know, 170,000-200,000. We see the rally upwards of like the halving already taking effect. They're buying the shit out of it with the ETFs. Tether's been wiped out. So there's like, no more FUD, guys. It's just ETHgate that's around the corner. It's just the exchanges that might go bust in September and October. I think that's the big shakeout. I think that's a really big fucking shakeout where we could get, I don't know, maybe from 170, 200K then to like 60K, back to 60K again, you know, back to like, oh, fuck. And then, you know, maybe people are going to get positioned out of their coins because exchanges default. They get a little bit of liquid. There's no the market.
Yep.
And then when they push everything out of. Yeah. And then when, you know, well, I'll wrap it up. Wrap it up. I'm just land my UAP right here. It's just that by then you get the election, then you get the 150 basis points, the economy goes to shit, and then everything goes into Bitcoin. I mean, we saw UBS with Credit Suisse, which is tied to GameStop, that's already kind of having an issue. And they're buying in on Bitcoin as well. So maybe after that, maybe after the election, I can see the real rally going upwards to like what? 1 million a coin, maybe more. And that's probably when we don't hash it out, but cash it out. And let me land it on that. Cash it out, guys. Cash it out. Yeah, episode number one today.
Well, we know it wasn't the goddamn eclipse. Because not only was there an eclipse, not only was CERN reactivated, not only did we shoot three rockets and there were spaceships and there was a guy that looked like Westwood now with bug glasses out there and UFOs and aliens and
this is going shit. A little bit in a realm that I don't really dabble in, to be very honest, but you know.
Yeah. Well, you don't listen to who we listen to, or else you would
be. Yeah, who would that be?
I'm just saying.
Who would that be?
No, I listen to everybody.
Is that Cliff High or what?
That's probably a good start.
You know what? From Cliff High on, and one day it's right. It's something we
I
don't
like the guy.
It's just we have been in here. I don't know. Some of us have been seasoned so much that now, yeah, dude. So you're saying it's April 16th or April 22nd? I'm waiting for the next date because it gives me a reason to stock up on tequila and then go, oh, well, at least I've got more tequila.
At least I got tequila. There.
Okay, it's the nomination day. Okay, well, it's the hottest day of the year.
How much tequila do you got? That explains a lot.
Now we get it.
I'm right next to the border. I got so much.
Yeah, I was always wondering about doing it first place, but now all of a sudden everything makes sense.
It's right here. I just came closer.
Fucking hell. Yeah, you know, for me, I just like to look at, like, the economy. That's what I'm focused on. I'm not really focused on, like, the news that mainstream goes after, whether that's an eclipse or even a war in Israel. I've tried to avoid all of that. It's so funny. People are like, what's your fucking opinion on Israel versus Palestine? And I'm like, yeah, what happened?
Yeah,
like
it's
like yeah, guy. Like dude, you're on the fucking news the entire time. Haven't you been paying attention to like what's happening? No, I've actually tried to avoid it. Well, I've actually like scrolled through it and be like, nah, not going to do this again. It's just another war with armchair generals. Whether that's Ukraine and now it's Israel, Palestine, and we've had so many wars that people then you know follow and shit. And it you know I understand it. It's fascinating who wins and why. You know, why is someone wrong and who's the scapegoat? I love that game. I it's just a little bit boring again. You know, it's the same old shit. And I need a little bit of new entertainment that, you know, fills my pockets with a little bit of money, especially in this economy.
Because well, just keep changing shit the narrative. Economy. Before it was that. And then
maybe.
Ukraine, like, there was Iran. And then before Iran.
Iran, Vietnam. Iraq. What's the difference?
I mean, there's always somebody that we're...
Well, it's the military-industrial complex, man. We got to keep that greased.
How else are they going to make money?
Right. So hear me out. So the military-industrial complex, they got a shit ton of money. Oil has been receiving a shit ton of money. You know. So your usual suspects and gold as well. So like your old fart money, they kind of made money already. I mean, they're ready. I mean, they got their money. And then you got all those stock buybacks of those rich motherfucking CEOs of S&P 500 companies sold all the shit. They got their money. Yep. Now you got, like, bonds rising, like, rapidly with mortgage rates. Like, yeah, they already cashed out with Blackstone right before the whole fucking rally. But they got their money. So, like, all these old motherfuckers that are in, like, real estate or silver or gold or treasuries or oil or, you know, you name it, or weapons. Yeah, they got their shit. Like they're done. They're paid off. Like, so they're ready. They're like, yeah, you can just break this whole fucking shit. You can tear the show down and we can buy it cheap again. But can't wait for a bottom. You know, can't wait for a good crash. Like, everyone's waiting for a good crash. So, and they can't have it yet in the election year, obviously. So I still think, like, they both need to have the legislation to get inflation under control, but they also need to crash it. Why not do two birds with one stone?
Well, because they need a war. Here's why. Because during wars and before wars, they seem to lose money. I think there was a report that was supposed to get. This is how much was unaccounted for. Was it billions or 2 trillion or 2.5 trillion?
Trillion. Two and a half trillion.
And it, without that, we can't. That's what they lost. That's not what they spent.
That's not what they lost. That's what they stole.
Yeah. That's what they're not going to account for.
Hey, he said it. Wait. He said it. He said it. I didn't say it.
Yeah.
You're not.
Yeah, you know. It's gone.
And it's gone. And it's gone. And where's the report? Where's Rumsfeld's report? It was in the Pentagon. It's where that plane hit.
Sorry. I was in that building that fell down. I don't worry about it.
Who asked for? Wait, who asked?
It was a boating accident.
They lost it in a building accident. What do you want?
That was a building accident. Yeah. I mean, these things happen.
Well, it does.
Have you ever seen a plane going into a building before? I mean, geez.
Yeah.
Ground level.
Yeah. Come on. This shit happens every day. Come on.
Hey, were there so many cameras, but not one of them got a picture of it?
No.
Buildings that fall by themselves.
There was one little video snippet.
Yeah, just one. Yeah. You
see that one? It was just like.
How does cast iron just go poof? Like the engine block.
Right? Science.
Science. Right. Fiance.
Right.
That's the science.
Why are you asking those questions, Dave?
Because I'm an automotive technician, Dave. And I know that if anything is going to survive, it's going to be the flipping engine.
That's you know how much papers there were for those lost trillions? Were those on the
all the files
with that report? That's a lot of heat. That's a lot of paper that could cause flames that could melt shit down.
So did we see the birth of like a new intelligence agency that day? It's like, dude, here we are, boom, and we stole your money. We're here, bitch.
We are going to go and start listening to all your Homeland phone calls. Security?
Well, that's the American way, isn't it? We'll just steal it.
Yeah. Now we're going to steal your privacy.
No, I'm in charge.
We're going to take away your privacy. We're going to know who takes it away.
Kind of like Gary Gensler. We'll just steal it.
Why not?
Yeah. But
you don't think it was that guy with a big fro and a hot girlfriend, young girlfriend, that did all that shit? I mean, please. Yeah.
In Gary's defense, though, in his case, it's a paper airplane.
It is.
And a paper tiger.
Well, nobody asks questions here. Stake? Nobody asks questions. Even us kind of ask it indirectly.
Oh, man.
I like to ask questions, but you know, not everyone wants to come on the show, so I can't blame them. You know, can't blame them.
Yeah,
horrible.
I can't blame them.
Yeah, it is what it is.
Yeah,
I got it now. It takes me a while sometimes.
This is just the world, and you guys are living in America. You got a front seat to this theater.
Oh yeah,
Well, and if you know a little bit about it and you don't watch TV, wow, it's so much more entertaining. If you watch TV, you get this, you kind of get drawn into it and you're like,
hey, if you're lucky, you're sitting in a booth in the theater with John Wilkes, right?
Yeah, I'm just here. You know, I look at the sand and
break a leg.
I go to the beach and sometimes I think I see a fish tail way in the distance. You know, I just mind my own business.
Yeah, you're going after fishtails.
Then it's a jellyfish when you get too close.
Oh. Yeah.
Oh, with tentacles. Man. Fuck.
Yeah.
It's a shark.
Shark.
Yeah.
So you got mermaids. You also got a bunch of whales there, or not? How does that work?
Whales and mermaids.
Well, those mermaids are pretty damn quick. They get away from those whales. Sometimes.
Right. Sometimes.
They'll sing a song.
That will change too in society when money is starting to become, like, you know, a real issue.
You're right, Steak. It's all about the bait, brother.
All of a sudden, there's a lot more relationships. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, you got good bait.
You don't need good bait because you can't survive on your own. Might as well be together.
Yeah.
Because, you know, the future we're heading is you'll be making the same amount of money you make now solo with the two of you.
Yeah, that's what's happening.
That's where we're heading. That's where we're heading.
Power, that's what's happened here in the U.S.
So you might as well start living under one roof.
Buy less.
But yeah. You know what? Go ahead.
No. It's okay. We got a little bit of delay. Go ahead.
I hear Westwood and his prices. And I'm still in the United States, even though I'm right next to the border. But yeah, there's the cost of living. I understand why the Canadians come here. Not only the Canadians, the people.
Look
from
at the
Colorado,
price of chicken.
People,
can you blame
everybody?
Them?
I
$220 on one of those drumsticks.
Yeah,
that was Alaska.
Alaska, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
But no, I mean,
Alaska, Alaska,
in, I mean,
Canada. You know, it's all up north.
That's New Russia, yeah. Alaska.
Yeah. It's up there. They screw things up there, up in the north.
Isn't it cold?
See, there's
down
a difference.
There? Yeah.
No,
it's yeah, a
supply chain issue. Takes a lot to get it up.
80 degrees here. 80 degrees. You actually see my fat whale ass riding a bike every once in a while. I actually had a bike with a also in tow with a little cart in the back. And
the cart in the back.
I threw his ass in the car and said, "Stay." And he did. It's like take off. And you know what? The way you keep him from jumping out, you go fast enough. The fucker doesn't want to go rolling.
Nope.
So,
Nothing buttons back there. Let him chew on him. One of those deer antlers.
You know, one thing I just can't get out of my head to go back to crypto again. It's like Dave said, you know, we're well over 40 shows now. And how long have we already been talking about the halving? You know, the whole fucking bear market. Yep. Years on end. And now next show, we'll talk about the halving because it has happened. You know, this is the one show before the halving. I mean, we're there.
Oh,
it's
wow. Just,
yay, yep. We're there.
You know what?
We are there. And it's so weird. We're near all-time high, and I'm not even fucking that happy.
kind of crazy, isn't it?
How fast you adjust to
because
it?
Because it's not enough.
There's mania everywhere. There's mania everywhere. Everyone's only talking about number go up. That's the other side of the equation that I think, you know, on the one hand, it's like, oh, we're at all-time high. And on the other hand, it's like, yeah, but, you know, it's going to fucking millions and hundred thousands and millions. And I can't wait what to do with my money. And I get it. But it's like for me, I just right now, I just really want to be in the team that, you know, we just got an all-time high. You know, it's just, all right. We'll see. You know, because we're going to get fucked if too many of us are thinking you.
Yes. Put it this way. Not too many of us can win. So you better be getting that coin that nobody fucking wants because.
Hey, what do you mean win? I mean, I've never made so much money so quickly already. I mean, you know, what fucking bank ever going to give you this? It's not enough.
Are you
applying for BlackRock right now? Because you're hired. You're hired.
I am. That's I had a visitor down here. It's not enough.
Well, you think about it, bro. You know, you used to think, $1 million is a lot of money. And now you think, I can't.
No.
That ain't going to be enough. If I got $1 million, I mean, it's going to get eaten up.
I mean, it's destroyed.
Look at you, Clint.
$1,000 a night for 1,000 nights.
Yeah, no, yeah, sure. But would you have thought 15 years ago? 15 years ago, would you have thought like $1 million that you would reply? Yeah.
You'd think I'd be all right. I could tell. Yeah, I'd be okay with a million. And I used to think that. You know, I'd be okay.
I grew up with that thing.
Can you live on that now?
Westwood and I grew up with, if you have $1 million and you're getting 10%, you're done. You retire for the rest of your life. You're set. You are just.
Then they went negative interest rates on us.
Yeah. And then a car went up to $100,000.
Right. And now the house, what's the cost of an average house in the U.S. now? I mean.
And a box of cereal is 20 bucks.
Yeah. $1 million ain't going to last long.
Well, I mean, you could get you a little house.
When you talk about a millionaire losing his money with $1,000 for 1,000 days, Dave. That makes sense, but honestly, the economy is going there. That if you eat chicken all day, you're already there.
You can't have steak. You need chicken. You have steak though. Steak is half the time.
I have noticed that. Go take a look. I don't know up in north, but here being down south, the big chains. I notice that the beef, because I get it from Florida, and I buy it. I buy a lot of beef. I enjoy eating big steaks. And I noticed that they're from smaller animals, and I believe it's because they're coming from Brazil. It's not the big,
you get the big corn
animals that we're used to. When I get a porterhouse, when I get a ribeye, a bone-in ribeye, there's a certain, I still get the thickness or even thicker, but it's a smaller cut. It's a wider cut, and that's a smaller animal.
The back's not so wide.
Yeah, it's not a big Angus. It's not a big white face shit that we have up in Colorado. So it's, our beef is not, how much does it cost beef for the processing that is cheaper from them to bring
should
it
we,
from,
should we buy, from should we buy should we buy stocks in like, I don't know. I mean, Bill Gates bought a bunch of farmland, right?
Right.
So, you know, he you know, like farms. Should we buy farms? Should we just do that?
China's got, they're controlling it.
What about China? I mean, about like farms here. I mean, you know.
No, they're chicken, here. That's who they own them.
Cows. I mean, if that's the price that we're going to be paying, holy shit. Yeah.
Well, they're talking about a new flu, and they're talking about the new bird flu. And
oh, no.
If they imagine,
that's just another eclipse. That's just another eclipse story. I'm not going to follow
it. There's a difference, Dave. You know what?
Yeah, this time it's different. That's what they always say.
Yeah,
that's how they get you.
This
time
it's
different. Fuck that shit. It's never different.
I've been buying a lot more chicken and grilling a lot more chicken than I do because the price of beef has gone up, and I like a good selective cut of it. And so what I am... What happens when you come up and you throw a wrench into that wheel and go, there is no more chicken because we got a bird flu, and you know what they're going to say? Go have a roast taco, motherfucker.
They're just going to say, oops, we have to print a little bit more money.
Hey, they're going to send me diapers and popcorn, and I'm just going to sit in my own, you know, and watch the show, I guess, you know.
Yeah, I'm going to get my own
Netflix.
Your tailor-made UBI.
Well, Westwood would know this answer, maybe. Do seagulls taste a lot like chicken? There's a bunch
seagulls,
of them flying
fucking
around.
Hell.
You go to Walmart.
Those are the rats. You know how we call those? We call those the rats from the sky.
It is. It's flying rats. But you know what? Hunger makes you taste things different. I've tasted a lot of different stuff. And I'm like, yeah, you know what? It does kind of taste like steak. And it doesn't. It wasn't had nothing to do with stuff. But that hunger makes you think that it kind of tastes. I got seagulls. I got some. They land right here. And it's so. I just do this. I should do this. I should do the show from the front porch. And I start going like this. I'll have so many fucking seagulls around here. I mean, if they taste like chicken, like Westwood says,
just drop a net on them. You're good to go. You got them.
I'll bring some to Westwood.
Well, there you go. Roast them.
Smoke them. They won't even know the difference. Barbecue.
Well, you see what they're prepping you for, though. You know, they make all that stuff expensive and supply chain disruptions, you know, takeovers of the farms. And next thing you know, well, we got these crickets ready to go. These grasshoppers.
Yeah. And they taste like chicken.
They smoke chicken.
They're pretty. I'm not going to lie. They're pretty
good, right?
You know,
well,
you
what
know
do
what farm legs
taste like?
Look. You know what we should do? I want to do a GoFundMe where we get the best transvestite, the best transgender, making a commercial for crickets. That'll sort it out. Then we're done immediately, just like with Bud Light. We'll call it Crickle Light.
Nobody will want them then.
You get frog legs? What does that taste like? What's everybody told you? Tastes like chicken.
Like
you go eat coon?
Like
what does it taste
alligator.
Like? Chicken. Alligator tastes like chicken. Well, what?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So what's the seagull going to taste like? Yeah. I mean, it's close to the chicken fat.
What's chicken going to taste like?
I have no idea. I'm probably eating something.
The new steak.
Chicken. Yeah, chicken. The new steak.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Look,
yeah,
it's
you
just
see where it's going.
It's a hell of a time to be alive.
We just got to learn to start eating with our eyes. Instead of our nose and our taste buds.
Ah, you want to talk
and
about
as long as it
again?
Looks like it.
Hey, they're going to have a vaccine for hunger. You know, you just take this and you'll be fine. It's all good. Well, they got Ozempic. I mean, they got all these weight loss drugs where it's like, oh, I'm not even hungry. Well, it costs me $3,000 a month.
The side effects of Ozempic.
Falls out and gets all twisted and okay. Then you don't need to eat them all.
But do you know what that thing does? Because it doesn't burn away fat. I mean, that's the thing that people don't realize. Like, you'll lose weight because it basically eats up every single fucking thing, including your bones, your fucking organs. Like, everything becomes smaller. So
you mean we can lose weight? We can lose weight.
I'm going to feel better.
And I'm going to be skinny. Yeah, my bones, whatever.
And insurance company's going to cover it, so it's all good, man. Everybody gets their money. It's all good. Yeah. Government will probably fund it, you know, because it's healthier. You know, you bring down the average weight of the Americans, you know, so it's better for us, better society, it's healthier.
Well, we've been doing it wrong.
Yeah.
Well, from what I hear, some people are eating people. Even in, it's starting to move. It's gone from Japan, I don't know, from Haiti, They were having barbecue. I'm just a messenger. This is what I see.
Hey, Javi.
This is how I'm educated. So I don't know.
Javi, that will scare off the immigrants when you start eating them.
That's an idea.
It's imported. That's fine.
I mean, yeah.
An exotic meat. Import.
Put a barcode on it.
Yeah. Right on.
Soylent Green. There's the show.
Exactly. Yep.
I don't know. Green. I know Westwood may be old enough to see it, but remember it.
That's an old one.
You know, that's exactly what we went to, and is that what they're preparing us to?
Wow.
20 years ago, Westwood, they would have said, you're going to be eating bugs. And you're going to, we had heard about people in third world countries that ate bugs. And you had gone camping and you were starving to death and you needed a source of protein, we knew we could eat a bug, but it wasn't in your Bisquick waffle
it was,
mix.
It was in lollipops. I remember that as a child. I was like,
it in tequila?
That's the one.
Yeah. Oh, man. Why you got to go there, Steve?
Wasn't there a worm in there?
Bite the worm. Well,
there was a worm in there.
Right.
You're right. Yeah, but that's a hallucinogenic. That doesn't count.
That's okay.
Yeah, that's a Moscato. Yeah. Dadgummit.
I don't know. I mean, if you do well on this stuff and you get into real assets, I mean, I guess that is one thing you really want to look at. I mean, like the most important asset that you have is what your energy source, you know, your own energy source, you know, clean foods. You see old King Chuck over there in England, he's got these organic farms and all this stuff. And, you know, I don't guess maybe it didn't help him, but, you know, I mean, elitists, they know. You think they're eating bugs? Give me a break.
No, I don't. But I did see something with crypto viewers, and Dick Gallagher had a little Twitter thing for a minute or two, and he remote viewed King Charles' inauguration. It was a sun, and he actually felt it. If anybody gets a chance, and I don't know how to look it up, but it's 2 minutes, and what he felt and what he saw and what. Dude, we've been controlled. We've been manipulated. They've got a time machine. And I think what's happening is finally Litecoin is about to break out, and then they reverse it all the way back. And so we live it again. And that's why Westwood is so freaking angry, because right before he calls it, it should be there.
The light's still on.
They go back, and they push us back, and then you're like, man, I felt that it was right there, but no, it's still early. Maybe I was, and you live it again.
Hang on, we might be at 3 digits right now. We might be back at 3. We're close. Mitch says it's 99.89 or something. 98 bucks. Yeah. It's right under the Mendoza line. Once it crosses that Rubicon, there ain't no coming back. Just saying. Until it does.
Exactly.
Well, well there's another one. Same thing with Digimon.
Yeah, it really is. I mean, but there's only so long. I mean, you think about it. If there are people out there that want crypto for sound money, I mean, there's not that much of it, of either one of those. Litecoin, Digibyte. I mean, yeah, there's not much Bitcoin either, but I think everybody's given up on sound money for Bitcoin. It's just a store of value. Yeah, you know, it's
yeah, we need a new flavor.
So
we need a new flavor. We're done. What about Apple and Apple Pay? Was that something you posted a stake? And it's in the EU going, being able to buy Bitcoin. Dude, they're making it very easy
Apple Pay.
For us to buy Bitcoin, or I don't know if it's an ETF or not.
Google Pay actually now has crypto listed up as well. So, you know, they're making a move, and they both together own more than 99% of the entire mobile market. So I think that's a very interesting move because it basically is part of the whole infrastructure around it that also starts to embrace it as the big players on Wall Street embrace it. These two players like Apple and Google are like, yeah, we're going. So they're ready. It's like for them, yeah. It's like, yeah, turn on the switch. And they already had the infrastructure done because they just put it in. It's like they say it's there and boom, it's there. So it's like they're ready. I mean, these guys are so fucking big. I mean, they've been waiting for it. And the only thing they've been waiting for is this whole ETF thing. And now it's like if they know that when Wall Street ETFs get bought up by the big, big, big investment funds like your BlackRock, your Fidelity, you call them. And there's a few more on the sidelines that are entering that have yet to enter, but they've listed for it. Big ones. Bank of America, Merrill Lynch, UBS. Big, big, big thing. Big fucking names. At some point, they will have to make profit. And how do they do that? They sell it to corporations. That corporations start
it's
to
just
adopt
like stocks.
The integration
you get a private
crypto.
Company, you put it on the stock market, and all that liquidity floods in.
Yeah, because all these big multinational companies, corporations, they all have portfolio managers, and they need to have a little bit on their balance, which will be maybe an allocation of like half a percent or maybe 1 or 5. That remains to be seen, but I think it will increase over time. And they need to have a percentage of that in their portfolio, and they'll just have crypto in it. They'll have Bitcoin in it.
Yeah,
and it's just the next step afterwards. And I think we're going to see that rapidly. And the question is that 4 years away, or is that happening in this cycle as well? And then we'll really get a super cycle. But, you know, that might be a little bit much, but I can really see it quickly going, you know, hyper accelerated, hyper Bitcoinization. I mean, we have the ETF in Hong Kong opening the whole Asian market, you know. It's if the Tether is going to go away in June, it's because of European legislation and the U.S. working in a tandem. So when you look at things, you're like, yeah, nothing is ready. But when it kind of happens, it's like all of it is ready. It's like everything. No one is making a mistake with their infrastructure not being correct. I mean, I don't hear any system going down. Everything works perfectly, phenomenally quick. It's been fully integrated. So no, this ETF, this ticker is a fucking game changer. I mean, I think that's already like the hooking on the new system on the old system. They already did it.
Well,
now it's just growing.
I agree. I'm offended that when every time Westwood leaves, we all assume that there's a crypto run. I leave. Nobody ever comments it. It's not like they think I'm buying anything. I'm just joking. I figured they weren't worried I was buying the wrong thing. Actually, I was making I made a half a cocktail because I didn't want
to. Oh, nice. Away. What kind of cocktail did you make? You
well,
go Bob Ross on
it's actually day. A mango margarita. I've been using this mango puree, and it makes me, well, I think it's the tequila that makes me slur, but it's pretty good.
It's pretty good.
A little
good.
Bit of chamoy in here. And
nice.
It makes
me
feel good.
You can probably hear my rain out there. I mean, is that coming through?
Oh, yeah.
It's raining like crazy out here now.
Well, maybe we're about to start losing part of the United States. Maybe we're losing part of the United States again.
Clint has a lot of liquidity issues.
you hear that, Westwood?
I can barely hear. It's raining so hard.
He says you got some liquidity issues.
Well, there's a lot of liquidity right now.
Yeah, it's raining.
I can say that.
I had that here last
time. Wow, liquidity. Making a lot of noise.
Make it rain, Clint.
But it's not raining the right thing. It's not raining money.
I know, right?
Be clear. Yeah. When you ask clearly. Well, I know.
I planted those money trees out there. I'm hoping they get liquefied. I don't know. Well, hopefully.
Oh, you're not being clear. You're just not asking for it right. Yep. That's the secret. Didn't you read that book a long time ago? I never read it, but.
Yeah.
The little engine that could.
Yeah. Just keep on chugging.
We're there, but since Hash has nothing to do with
I'll have to go re-listen to that. I won't do it, but you know I should.
Oh, that's an interesting question in the chat.
Well, you can probably ask tomorrow. I think what's that guy that doesn't like to interrupt but interrupts a lot? I forget his name. Anyway, he goes to your space. You could ask him.
Oh, hey, okay. Dave, the question is kind of interesting, right?
Yeah, I know. That's why I left it up.
Right. So do you think Bitcoin Core will be attacked by people wanting to approve it? I do. Next crypto civil war is coming. Crypto red pill people will go after it. I'd like to comment on that. Today, Michael Saylor, the news was broke, or yesterday, actually. The news broke allegedly that Michael Saylor was going scolding and one of the biggest ETF fund players that, and they didn't name which one, whether it's FANEC or BlackRock, that they wanted to fund developers for the Bitcoin Core, and Saylor didn't want that because you would influence the market there and maybe, you know, centralize that part of decentralization in the Bitcoin Core. And I actually asked Laura what she thought about that in regards to like the 501c3, because that's meant, you know, as a tax write-off in the US that you could fund developers with or educational material. And Saylor doesn't really want it for Bitcoin. Are we going to get it for Digibyte? I think it's inevitable. Maybe ethically people won't like it. Certainly someone like Saylor, which has a large stake in it, that no pun intended, that you know, Bitcoin remains successful because its whole company is built on it. So I can understand where he's coming from his position. But like, I think it's actually inevitable at some point that developers will get funded. I mean, it makes no sense if they wouldn't get funded by the market to build things that maybe the market needs. And at a certain point, I think that's inevitable. And I think certain developers will probably never accept it. But I also think new developers might come that might want to accept it and just build on it. So, yeah, that's my kind of take on it. So if there's a civil war coming, I think they can live side by side or maybe even on different chains. Maybe we will get a fork, one that has paid developers and one that doesn't. Could be.
I'm just glad Michael Saylor is such a humanitarian that decides to help the small people like ourselves, him being so wealthy and is giving.
Well, it's also in his own interest. Look, I'm glad he's a good guy. You're completely right in it, but it's also in his complete own interest.
Yeah, no.
You know, if Bitcoin stays relevant, he stays relevant. So, you know, I don't want to shit on the guy because he's great, but it's like, you know, I don't want to think that he's holier than the Pope, right? It's just.
No. Yeah, because the Pope is really holy.
Yeah, yeah.
Really?
Figure of speech.
Yeah. Anybody else we could disassociate groups with? With and knock down Dave's 500 count, because he said he hit 500. So we need to knock some of those people out of there. I just when I hear Michael Saylor, when I hear Elon Musk, when I hear people like that giving me advice out of the kindness of their heart. And they don't have, what is it, a GoFundMe page or anything else? I'm like, I don't know. It's just like a thing. Hair stands. You got that same problem, Wes, with hair on your back kind of stands up. It's that warning sign that we usually get. Just get that Sasquatch feeling. And that's it. I don't know. I'm one of those people that when people speak, I read that and I don't get that. You know, some of these presidents tell me they want to help me. I don't know.
You know, I saw
they tell me going it's for back, my own good.
Speaking of presidents and how successful they all are, you know, because they'll tell you, you look at the, what was it? I think, Dave, you might have posted this. Somebody posted this to where every president, you know, the debt goes up. You know, we go further in debt. And you look at, I saw the statistic today, I think it was, because they're talking about the CPI, the Consumer Price Index. It's gone up. It's been what? Gone up every month, you know, since Biden's been president, whatever it is. I don't know. But you got to look at it. You know, if you know what inflation is the inflation of the monetary supply. And that doesn't happen right away. It doesn't spill over into prices. You got to go back and look in the prior administration because of, you know, we had a pandemic, you know, and we had to print a bunch of money. But it was like $8 trillion that got created. Well, so, yeah, we're seeing the effects of it now. So it doesn't matter who's president. Yeah, there's been some bad policies. I'm not defending him, but it doesn't matter who. It doesn't matter because the monetary supply was already ballooned up. It's going to flow into the economy and into prices.
Yeah. Let's put it this way. At that point. I'll take this bet. Whoever's president next, it's Trump.
If going trillion.
Up, I bet. I'll bet.
Trillion.
Yeah,
I don't care.
No, it would be a doubling.
Let's go back. You know what? You're 100% right. You're 100% right, Westwood. But let's go back to the beginning of our presidents. It just didn't go up that much in percentage as it is now that we've got a little machine that just. And so.
It's the hockey
our taxes
stick.
Are going up.
It's the hockey stick.
Right.
This is where let me cheer state to where he feels better living in the Netherlands. Right now, it's a known fact that most people in the United States can't make it on their salary, that they're having to use a credit card to make their monthly payments.
Well, that's what happens here. It's all debt-based. Anything new that people get, cars, houses,
it's all debt-based.
Nobody's paying for it.
How does that end up?
Well, I mean, there are, but they're not living in the houses.
So you know how you fix that? Go get another job, Westwood. Go get another job.
Raise that minimum wage. That'll help.
Get that three. There's medicine for that. You don't have to sleep. I think so. Taking up that medicine, you don't sleep. And you can work 8 hours a day. Yeah. How many of that time go to the 24-4? Got plenty of work.
I think you
can afford something.
I think the amount of people that are going to be homeless is probably going to increase.
Sounds kind of like the 30s during the Great Depression, maybe? I don't know, cycle? 100 years?
Javier, you know, how many people own things? And even if you do own it, I mean, there's the massive tax burden, licensing vehicles. I mean, there's things that have to be done just to hold on to those assets.
Well, let's be clear. You need to explain what is. What do you mean by own? Own, most people assume that car outside is theirs. No.
Don't license it and drive it down the street.
The bank owns that car. It's not yours. It's not. So what is, as soon as you understand that is, doesn't happen to really mean is. And you can go back and I think, Slick Willie was in a lawsuit about that.
Yeah.
Once you find out what is the definition of is, then you'll understand how. Well, you may not get it on your your shirt or dress or anything else, but you're gonna get it. Just saying. I'm trying to keep it clean, Dave.
No, but I mean, Paulie P says everybody's gonna be on universal basic income. Well, I mean, over 50% of Americans are already. I mean, through Social Security, through diapers to, you know, daycares to, you know, SSI to whatever the government benefit. I mean, most people, a lot of people won't survive if that's taken away now. So, I mean, you're looking at over 50% of America is already on a form of UBI.
And we will not call it socialism. We're not going to call that socialism.
In a way, the debt system, the debt system that every American is hooked on, is basically your UBI.
Yeah. Whatever that means, we're hooked.
Oh, right here. You are.
Well, and
right here.
I just found out I got some intel, some information on. Okay, so like under my Social Security number, I look poor, but the trust, the EIN number, is not.
Right.
However, I just found out though that through my insurance, I get other benefits that I was unaware of. I get like $112 a month to spend like on healthy food or on over-the-counter prescriptions. Well, and I also found out that I can apply that $112 a month to electric costs. So I just did that. Thing, you know, light went off, right?
Yeah.
So electric costs, right? So the mining and whatnot that I'm doing, it's like, so I get an extra $112 a month for free.
And you are one of the people,
If that is tax money, I think that you owe it to the working class Americans that might be listening right now
to
say thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
At least Westwood or so. I don't know.
Again, it's through my insurance. So
send
it's
popcorn.
Like, right, it's through my insurance. It's not like it's through the energy company.
You're not overpaying on your insurance. Don't worry about it.
No, I don't pay. I qualify for a state grant. You're one of them.
I don't get insurance.
I mean, it pays for itself because, like I said, I own nothing and I am happy.
Yeah,
you know, on paper I look poor.
Some of us don't get insurance and they need it because they go to Westwoods and they help with fire pits.
Man, and maybe there's something maybe I should start.
We need an insurance policy.
I have a high deductible.
But I mean, look at what just happened to me last month. I just had my electricity cut off yet again. It's not that I didn't have the money to pay it. It's just I got so much stuff going on that I forgot about it. And yeah, I get the bill and whatnot. And yeah, it gets sick.
The miners get shut off and like, what the?
Well, no, I was having the electrical run out to the shed for the mining shed and everything, and the electrician's like, you have no power. I said, oh, it's flip the breaker on outside. He went and flipped the breaker on, still no power. I'm like, they're probably working on it down the block or something. And sure enough, I call in, they say, oh no, it's because of lack of payment. I'm like, you shut off the electricity of a special needs person to start with, and I'm listed as special needs. They're not supposed to cut special needs power. And it was for 2 months, and it was like $280. Look, I could totally understand if someone owed like $600 or a grand on their electric bill, but you cut someone off for like $280, man. And I had already paid them. I had already sent the check in the mail. And then what happens, of course, over the weekend, they shut it off. I'm like, well, I already sent you the check. They're like, well, you have to pay us again, just wait until we receive payment. I'm like, it's already been 3 days. And so anyway, I had to make a whole nother payment, you know, and just to get the electricity turned back on. Now to find out that I was actually supposed to have been getting a special benefit towards my electricity. And I'm just like, wow, really? This whole time, I never used it. I didn't know I even had it. So yeah, if y'all are on Social Security and Medicare, go check out your Medicare and see if that's part of your plan. If you get like healthy benefits and over-the-counter help and that kind of stuff, because I didn't even know I had it.
Yeah.
But
So Westwood, you know where our tax dollars go to supplement
Dave's unspent money from Dave.
To supplement Dave's Are you going to get some of that? Mining, goddamn shit. But yeah, here, let me go work some more, Dave, to get you more money for your mining, you goddamn equipment. Okay? I call it like it is. Okay?
Now the ROI is looking pretty damn good.
Oh, Dave's like, all right. Yeah, we're looking
some
good.
Overtime, Westwood. He needs more damn electric. He's got his miners going.
Need bigger pipes.
Somebody's got bigger wires.
But looking back over the years, dude, I did jobs that no one else will do.
Oh, I know,
and,
my brother.
And I don't know how many lives I have left, but I'm close to 8 for sure. You know, there's several times I should not be here right now from different jobs that I've had. So, like an iron workers union, I almost fell off the top of the Fairmont Hotel here in New Orleans. I was, you know, that's a 135-foot drop. Almost died twice there. Then once again at NASA in Stennis in Mississippi, building a rocket test facility there. Almost died there. The guy that walked in front of me actually did die. He fell through the grate into the chute, 86 feet to his death. I mean, and I had already walked over the same piece of grating that the guy in front of me had walked on. So, I mean, there's many times I should not be here. And I don't know how or why, but
how many times have you been to Westwood?
3.
Uneventful. Push the limits, Dave.
And you're still blind? Well, you're not doing it right. Yeah,
you're going to Westwood after that.
Try again.
Yeah, you're doing it right.
We did try
to get him to drive a car to some liquor store or some golf cart that you had. I don't know what the hell it was.
I put him on the scooter once with a walking stick.
With a walking stick.
That's an NFT for sure.
That is an NFT. It's on the wall over here.
Just saying. I don't know. You ain't doing it right.
Well, actually, I think I am doing it right.
Yeah. Well, I think Polly P's doing it right. He's got a Colgate smile, all smile. He looks good. Everybody's doing it right.
And that's it. I guess that's the thing. We're all trying to figure it out because we know it's a pretty rigged system. I mean, it's like, what do? They force you to – I mean, if you're a normal person, they force you into a game to where it's like, okay, I got to gamble and figure out something to get ahead because I'm not going to get ahead doing what I'm doing. I'm trying to do the right thing. I'm trying to do everything. So, you know, it's like, well, I guess I'll go play the lottery. I guess I'll get a second job. I guess maybe I'll get into crypto. Maybe that's a way out. What's the way out? I mean, everybody's looking for a way out because we know there's no way out of that casino the way it is. Yeah. We got to figure something out.
Throw the bones.
Well, it is truly insurance. So I began in metals before crypto, and that was the way I always looked at metals it was insurance.
Same.
It protects you in the migration from one monetary system into another.
Yep.
So because how much is a Confederate note worth today?
Exactly.
So to move from one monetary system into the next, gold and silver have been there for thousands of years to protect against paper tigers in this way. As well as other draconian measures. And that's the way that I view crypto as well, is that will have value regardless of what the fiat currency is that is used or across any multiple border. So, and without the threat of civil asset forfeiture, like you would have with your gold or silver, memorize 12 words, you're now global, dude.
Yep.
So,
and you just define the definition of sound money that exists when the government fails.
Yeah, I just have one question. One question for Westwood.
Yeah.
Is that a Bud Light shirt?
No, it's a Budweiser shirt. No.
Okay, I can just see the Budweiser.
It's different.
Okay, I wanted to know before we went on because I was like,
oh yeah,
I wasn't going to be able to be on the show with you at the same time.
Yeah, I know, right?
So actually, that $112 that I'm going to be getting from you other taxpayers.
Almost.
Again, thank you. So that $112, I purchased quite a few ASICs And what I will do is I will have a giveaway of one of the ASICs. I mean, they're probably like $180-$190 right now. If you want to buy one used, like an old L3. So I'll do one of those as a giveaway. Y'all have seen that before, but you know, I just want to let that aware that, you know, I see that and I thank you for it. And I'd like to give a little something back and maybe help someone else out who needs it.
Well, thank you, Dave. That's very big of you.
Yeah. All you got to do is subscribe. Yeah. Subscribe, yeah, and get me.
We're trying to get that infinity number of 1,000.
Yeah, no doubt.
How long have you been out of Westwood?
I know. It starts getting close to 1,000, then I back off the video.
I'm sorry. I'm like, I don't want to hit 1,000.
Backing down.
You know, Dave. You know, Dave.
I am that guy.
At the beginning of the show, you would tell people, you know, if you need help setting up a show, it can help you, you know. But we can't get 1,000 subscribers.
No.
I mean, how many hours you got? 6,000 hours or something?
Yeah, I got like 6,500 hours. I got like 6,500 hours. And the thing is that I have so many hours because I created so many videos over the years because I couldn't find help to figure out how to make what did what and how I could get like six different softwares to work together simultaneously for me to be able to do this. Well, I finally figured it out after so long, and that's how I have so many hours. So a lot of people go back and review old content, and I thank you for that. But you know, share a video or two once in a while for us and help us out. Help us get to 1,000 subscribers. I mean, you know, it's just a matter of time. That's why, you know, like you had asked me, I think all of y'all asked me, why do I want to start a show now? And that was 41 weeks ago. I said, because we're at the bottom of the market.
Mm-hmm.
We were.
Yeah. That's when you want to build.
Well, yeah, exactly.
You know what? My father made a point. He's pretty funny sometimes. He said, and I was going to ask to all hold hands, do a little prayer, but he goes, you know, when he watches these soccer games, and especially the American ones, and every time they score a goal, shoot their finger up to God, and right here, number one. And my dad was curious how many of those motherfuckers go to church on Sunday. He doesn't figure very many, but they do all their praying on the field. So just say it. I don't know where that came from. Probably the second tequila.
Well, thank they God probably didn't kneel also. They probably kneel during the national anthem.
More ways than one. Well, never know.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's why I wanted to clarify that one a little more.
Yeah, it's tequila.
I don't even know where it's going. Yeah.
Blue agave.
Mm-mm-mm. Well, the sun's coming out now, so there's no chance of getting struck by lightning, hopefully.
Yeah, that's a good thing.
Yeah. You never know.
You still there? Have we cut
you
off?
Yeah, we're here.
What's your blood sugar, Steak?
Yeah, what's your blood sugar?
My blood sugar is great. Yeah, thanks for asking. Pretty good, actually.
See where mine is.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm just happy you didn't get hit by lightning, Clint. You
know, I know.
That would have sucked if your tombstone would have the Lightning Network logo on it.
I know, right? That would have been bad. That wouldn't have been good.
Yeah, I think you got
the wrong hash. Litecoin, you know.
Yeah, nothing. Stakes got the wrong hash rate working.
Yeah.
It just seemed a little bit quiet.
Well, that's like the attorney that, you know, his client wanted to be buried with $10 million, and the attorney says, okay, no problem, I'll bury you with your $10 million. So, you know, the funeral and whatnot. So the attorney comes up, writes a check for $10 million, puts it in his casket. You know, he buried him with $10 million, but
there you go.
You know, the attorney walked away with it.
Yeah.
No wonder they call them sharks. But yeah, it's
trying to think of a death joke for escrow, but I don't know. I'm not
finding. I do want to give a big shout out to our listeners. If anybody's listening, I know that Lisa's having her thing tomorrow this month. Yeah,
122.
I want to make it there, but I'm too far south right now.
Is that on Twitter or YouTube?
Both.
Actually, I think you can hover over it. I can. So I have 32 on one Twitter account, 72 on another Twitter account, and 18 on YouTube. So if you hover over, if you hover over the number, it'll break it down for you. I heard Crypto Blood mention that in a video, so I wanted to try it. So thank you for asking.
So Dave, basically, you got more followers on your dating app than you do on YouTube.
Well, yeah, I mean, I tie all of this into what is that? OnlyFans. So
just curious. Hey, you should talk to some of those people. Maybe they're coming.
No.
Or
they're all a liability. They're all a liability. They want too much. Next thing I know, they want to move in, kick their feet up, quit their job, leave the fucking windows open while the AC's on because it got hot or they got cold, you know. And it's just like I'm batting 1,000, yo.
Well, let's reel it back because I think
I often question: am I not well because I didn't take?
Oh, you're not well. Yeah, you're not well. It's not them. It's you.
I figure it's me. Now I know it's me because used to I used to look around and just go, how am I cut from the same cloth?
Yeah,
you know, I look around at family and I'm just like, I know there's one in the family, but is it me? You know,
you're the one.
Well, put it this way, David. When you got Jazz Fest coming up in New Orleans?
Yeah.
You got visitors coming? Yeah.
It's supposed you. To. I don't know. Well, no, this one, her family owns and it's a huge outlet there at Jazz Fest. And I've worked there before. It used to be fun to go there and work. And really, I would go there, work, free food, and then I get to go, you know, to the live shows. Like, I mean, I don't even know who's playing this year. But I'm, you know what? I'll look it up. But yeah, it's supposedly she's coming in town, you know, to, you know, again, it's like, why, you know, your mother and your aunt and your uncle, you know, run the show. And it's like, and you want to come stay with me. And it's like, for what? You know, I only got one bed.
He hasn't figured it out, Westwood. Can you explain it to him?
I only got one bed. There you go.
Yeah. Well, conveniently, he's got one bed. And so it's like, well.
That's all I got.
No, I'm not going to touch her. It's, no.
You know, that's one of those Polly P throwbacks or something?
No, it's just that, you know, it doesn't seem right. It doesn't feel right. It's like, so no, I'm not going to. If it doesn't feel right, I'm not going to do it. You know, it's like, and this totally doesn't feel right. Something else is going on. Something else is at play. You watch. Just wait and see. This girl's going to come up with some grand story and be like, I miss living here at home, you know, and I want to move back. It's like, yeah, right. You want free rent? Okay. You want, you know, eat all my food? Okay. You know, no.
Yeah, this is upstate, Sally. Steak, you got any advice or Dave?
None at all.
No. Hey, get some hash. Get some hash. It's better.
No, I hear you. Doors, I hear you. Plugs in. Look, Dave, I hear you. Fuck him. Yeah.
No.
What did Elon say? What did Elon say? I think that's Well, let's get back to a little bit to what, and I think this is important where our people like to listen to. Y'all's advice of what's going to happen next week after the having, I know that my opinion is, I don't know, it doesn't really matter what my opinion is, nobody wants to hear it. But I know that they would like y'all's opinion.
I already gave it.
Yeah, he gave a timeline of all the different things. I mean, if you look at it historically, I mean, it doesn't like moonrocket right after having. Usually, it takes like 2-3 months, you know, before, you know, kind of going sideways. And I mean, because you got to think, you know, the supply just got cut in half, like Dave's been talking about. You know, you're throwing all this money and equipment, and now you're getting half the reward. So there's a little bit of grind there, like, oh man, you know, I'm not getting all the, you know, I'm not getting as many coins. It's not as much money coming in. But I mean, you know, if you just look at the past cycles after the halving, you know, it could be the month after it starts going up pretty good.
What about Litecoin? 3 months,
4 months even before it really starts taking off to that last leg of the bull market. Now, again, it could be different this time because, you know, we've got all this money influx and, you know, that could, who knows what's going to happen. But I mean, I don't see, you know, I used to, you know, like if you look at the past episodes of this, I thought we were going to go a lot lower in Bitcoin on corrections prior to the halving. I haven't seen it. And that's probably because there's a lot more money in it. You know, we have had some dips, but the dips haven't been deep. And they probably won't be that deep now, just from the standpoint of you do have a lot of money into it. But don't think so there won't be dips.
Yeah. So you say you used to believe? And now you do. No, I'm just joking. Doesn't Litecoin?
I kind of sort of thought I believed something, but now I'm not sure what I believe. No. But yeah, it is a little bit different. I mean, there's a lot of money out there.
It is. There's a lot. I wish O'Dub was here. We can go and crucify him too, because he keeps up a lot. He's got that youthful attitude. He's, you know what? He's in a new thing with the play. I don't know. I don't play games. I'm a grown up now, so I don't play. And Dub, I said that. Yeah, I don't play video games or whatever the hell you're doing. Yeah. But no, he's into some new thing, and good for him. Hey, dude, he's a young guy after it, but he's, you know, a lot of knowledge. I wish he was here to give his opinion, and I had heard Litecoin runs before, but then again, I've heard a lot of different things.
I mean, it depends. I mean, you know, I think, I mean, you know, unfortunately for Litecoin, it's still, you know, you're still living in the shadow of Bitcoin, and so, you know, you're going to have, I guess, a confirmation, so to speak, from Bitcoin that, hey, you know, we're in this full-blown bull market, and then, you know, there's a lot of room for Litecoin to run and other coins, all the altcoins for that matter at that point. But, you know, we've seen Bitcoin go sideways for, you know, a little bit of time now. You know, a few weeks ago, everybody was exuberant saying, hey, we're going big, you know, and then it, okay, then it just kind of died down and went sideways a little bit, a little bouncing around, range bound. But once it really takes off again and the, you know, the excitement will come back. But again, that's why you have these cycles, just because, you know, that human emotion takes time to, you know, the ebb and the flow of things. And, you know, what the price is going to be, who knows? But the energy levels are going to be the same, I think. You know, you're going to see those, that hysteria, you know, and all that FOMO and all that euphoria. It just takes some time to recover from that before it can build up again. So, I don't know. I mean, it'll be back before you know it.
Yeah, are they going to be shorting the market? I figure that's exactly what they're going to do. Raise it, pump it, short the market.
Get as many coins as they can. They're going to try to accumulate as much Bitcoin because as they can.
This isn't the old game of the old hodl. There was hodlers like me that still have a frickin' soul and wait for their first opportunity to sell. But yeah, there's, you know, we believed in that kumbaya moment. I drank Kool-Aid. I sang the song.
And you know, you're right. I mean, you know, going back to what you said earlier, I mean, I just want to live in a world where we have decentralized money, where it's not run by the banks and where they don't rig it and they don't go 50 trillion, you know, plus in the next administration. Well, in the next administration will be more than that. But I mean, in the next year. And it's just because all that does is just put us in this situation where we've got diapers going to the daycare. I mean, you know, where we need more stuff. You know, we people think they need more goodies from government. Well, I paid in. I deserve more back. And it's like, it ain't there. It's all fake. I mean, the monetary system's broken. And you've got an opportunity now to get out of it and use something
else. ETF is broken. We're just playing the game. I mean, if we're going to have the ETFs, we're going to play the game that way. And we have decisions to make. Right now, whether we get out of the market up to a point, because, hey, nothing's for sure. We can get out of the market and it could end right there, or we could get out of the market and we could never buy back in at this price again. We don't know. But yeah, it's I wish we did, but we beat it up. We beat it up hard in this before, after, during. I call Dave every day. He talks to everybody that he can. There is no definite right now. I don't know. I want it to be a, you know, I hear what State says and I'm all over the dude. I've been through a long time to where, you know, shit, that not too long ago there was a Litecoin happening. I was waiting for an alt, which should have been there. Put it this way, the price of Litecoin shouldn't be at this price right now. The price of Digibyte shouldn't be at this price.
The market will determine what has value and what lasts. And I mean, a lot of things States talked about, you know, some of these coins aren't going to last. I mean, they're just going to get regulated out of existence, or, you know, who knows what's going to happen to them. We'll just fail. And I mean, if you've got a $4 situation, people, there's going to be a flight to real assets, things that actually hold value.
Explain that, Dave. The cost of compliance. What do you mean by that?
Well, if there's regulation that you have to comply with, and it's not in the protocol, you have to build extra infrastructure in order to make sure that you comply with the regulation. So that will be just another layer on top of everything that you've never built the entire project for in the first place. So it just either won't scale in speed or.
Well, who's compliance? If it's the U.S. compliance, because if we're going after people, if we're going after Binance Boy or whatever his name is,
you already went ZZ after Binance. CZ already got arrested in December.
Okay, can China come after some of our boys here? I mean, why do we have the right to go outside of our jurisdiction, outside the U.S.?
Because why do we have 200 bases around the world?
Hold up. Binance was doing business in the U.S.
Sure.
I mean, let's not, you know, compare apples to oranges. If your boys in the U.S. are doing business in China and they're not upholding by the Chinese law, yeah, of course they can get arrested in China. I mean, why not?
Well, so China, wait. So what you're saying is that China, Ochi, could go in and send their boys over here to the U.S., pull them out of the U.S. and take them back to China? Is that what you're telling me?
If they were operating under the CCP, then yes.
Don't they have like Chinese police stations in New York and San Francisco and different places?
Well, I know here at the border they ain't got shit. They can come right back. Because they're not checking anybody over here. But, right, but what I'm saying is, why are we the regulators of everything going on in the world? And aren't we screwing ourselves?
Why are we?
United States. The people, I don't...
You kind of won a bunch of wars.
Well, yeah, but you know what? At that point, why don't we own the world then? Why don't we just go, fuck it?
You do.
The world is ours.
You do.
That's kind of what they're done with the dollar, right?
Right now, and I'm going to tell you this, State. Don't underestimate you. Just go up and put Chi Mexico. Just do that. Go put Germany in Mexico. Well, we are getting the inner structure.
Hey,
Harvey. We are starting to move the power into the Americas.
Harvey's about to get on
We will find out soon where the power comes from.
Very simple. Federal Reserve. Who do you think funded China's progress?
You mean the Federal Reserve has got nothing to do with the United States?
Who do you think paid for it?
So it was us.
Yeah.
But put it this way, it wasn't us, because that Federal Reserve is just like the Federal Reserve. It's not the United States. No, it's got nothing to do with the United States. It's a separate group of people that are not in the United States, got nothing to do with the United States, yet they put the laws and use the military power.
I am really having trouble following you.
Maybe it's a fucking tequila. I'm seeing the corruption too much here, Stake. And maybe I'm wrong. Maybe it is a kumbaya moment. We should all go to church and pray. But thank
Look
you.
What you made me do.
Yeah.
So now you got me drinking.
It happens. Salud.
Cheers.
I don't know. We shouldn't come in and start regulating everything. And we are the power. We regulate everything, I guess.
Well, I'll say it this way. Guadalajara y Lake Chapala looks interesting yet again. I'll say it that way. I mean, for $1,000 a month, I can go retire and live on my Social Security disability alone.
No, seriously, I think you'll see a lot of expatriates.
Yeah, short to midterm, exactly. Short to midterm, exactly.
The reason why I say Guadalajara is that's where major medical is of Mexico.
Yeah, and I mean, you can actually buy stuff that you can't get here, I imagine. You know,
10 times less the price.
Right. You know, at some point you're going to draw. I mean, it's just like this state I live in, Illinois. I mean, you see all these big businesses moving out because it's like, it doesn't make sense to be here. Are you just going to tax us to death and, you know, regulate us out of existence and you just run us into the ground? Fine, we'll go somewhere else. We'll go to Texas. We'll go to Florida. I mean, you know, someone's going to have people that have wealth in the U.S. They're going to say, F it, I'm out. I'll go somewhere else.
Here was something else involving crypto. So, like, if I did the visa to Mexico, is only for a 6-month visa is only $20, but I don't know, would that give me, like, would that then be able to allow me KYC into other exchanges? I know that I can go get, like, not a dual citizenship, but it might be, but an ID in Palau, I can go do that now for, like, I don't know, under $300, and then I can go around all the KYC at all these other exchanges. So, you know, if you're listening, that may be an option for you to look at.
I mean, why do you think everybody's going to El Salvador? You see all these videos of everybody going to El Salvador. Man, F this. This is great here. No, all these Americans going down there, which I don't know, man.
I'm going to tell you, Westwood, there is a big difference. Diesel here is anywhere from $3 to $3.25 a gallon. The fruit is basically given to you. You go anywhere. And you don't buy it at the supermarket. You just buy it at any state. They basically give you limes, lemons, but anything the hell you want, watermelon, melons, apples, pears, whatever the hell you want, you get it. You know what? It's got a little brown spot. It tastes the same. It's okay.
Mermaids swimming up to your feet on the beach.
What's the kilowatts per hour charge in like Lake Chapala? That would be
electric can be high as long as but if it gets too high, you just steal your neighbor. You run an extension cord over there.
So you bring all your American value.
There's a way. Where there's the will, there's
a way.
All the miners
are migrating instead.
I know
of
people that mine in Mexico.
Instead of the miners migrating on SHA-256, now the miners will be migrating to cheaper electricity.
Yeah, people are mining there.
Right.
You'd be I'm paying 12 cents a kilowatt hour, but you know, I don't know, less now because thank you, taxpayers.
Yeah.
Again, you right. know, for $112, it's like $110.50 after they take $1.50 a fee to apply that towards my electric bill. And I'm like, okay.
Process.
Yeah, I could say, Dave, I'm good with that, man. You know what? You're disabled. You've worked. You've earned it. Good. I'm glad. Can't say that about everybody else. I mean, right now, why not you? Why other people that are coming in here without the proper documentation?
You know, it used to be, what was it, Belize or maybe Costa Rica, to where, you know, $50,000, you know, you bring it into the economy and they make you a citizen. I mean, there are countries like that, probably still now, I'm sure, to where, hey, bring your money here, you're a citizen. You know, you're going to be productive, come on in, make you a citizen. You know, that's going to get attractive to people. Think about it. You know, you put $40,000 in Bitcoin and bought one Bitcoin, it goes to $100,000, you might say, you know, the cost of everything else is going up, maybe I'll take that and I'll become a citizen somewhere else and live for 10% of the cost, you know?
Well, let's break it down. Let's break it down. Where is Peter Schiff live? Outside the U.S. Outside U.S. jurisdiction. Where the,
same with Mike Maloney. They all
live same with Mike Maloney. Well, let's keep going. What about Bitcoin Jesus? Where does he live? He doesn't live here. He left here. There's plenty more. There's a reason for that.
Yeah, rich dad,
poor even dad. Though they are extremely wealthy, there's advantages that they don't get. I don't know. F this bad over there? Is there a reason why? I mean, why would you?
There's a reason why Trump
is the greatest country in the fucking world. Yeah. Why would you leave the greatest country in the world?
And why not take that example, say, of Trump with rental property and write off the improvements against my capital gains? So I did just that. And I'm going to continue to do that.
Mm-hmm. And you know what? We need to spread that knowledge to the rest of the people.
That is the game.
Want to stay here.
Then I'm going to put my own damn lien on my own property.
Exactly. No, seriously. I mean, that's, yeah. And I mean, that's, yeah. You start protecting yourself.
Uh-oh.
Nope.
Too much truth.
We lost them.
Too much truth.
Loopholes in the way it works. You have to find those things. The system forces you to do those things. And it's really not a level playing field. So unless you've gotten to that point where you can do that homework, that's why it's important for everybody to share it. That's why you're sharing it, Dave, to help other people. But I mean, there's so many people. They're just like, hey, I just got to go to work. I just want to work. I just want to work, and I want to get paid, and I want to be able to spend that money, you know, get a steak, you know, once in a while, whatever. And they're finding that that doesn't work. And so now they're like, what do we do?
I don't know what to do. Here's something else I don't hear anyone else explaining. Is that there's a feedback again.
Okay.
But something else that I don't hear a lot of other people explaining is the beautiful thing that Digibyte has been able to do with the 501c3, in that I can now take if I want to be in a different tax bracket, I can then give a donation to a 501c3 for a tax write-off and actually fund development. So going into bull runs, I think that this, in the future of the Digibyte Alliance, of 501c3, is going to play a major role in the development of Digibyte when some of us do take profit. So yeah, I would like to share that with y'all.
Yeah, I know one up north.
So be your own charity.
Well. Does that mean that you've basically sorted that out?
Not 100%, no, but I mean, to any 501c3, if I were to do that and leave a donation, I would then get a receipt of that donation to write off on my taxes, depending upon which tax tier I want to be in.
And you know what? You at least get your tax dollars to where you want. And that's
right,
me. I'm okay
I would much rather leave a $10,000 donation instead of paying $10,000 to leave those amount of arms in Afghanistan.
Sure. Thank you. And it's their system. I don't know how long they'll let it run before they change the damn rules.
You know what would be funny? If you would put all the money that you would get from the government into 501c3. That's hilarious.
I put that in a trust.
Yeah.
And the rest. Yeah, you know what's fake? It's just this system. It's really, really, put it, there are rules. You've got to be rich enough. You've got to be a multimillionaire to be able to afford the information from the groups. If you're not, then you're going to get screwed. You're just going to have to pay. You're going to do it the hard way.
No, you're right. Because, you know, if you're coming from a, let's say, a multi-generational family, because we've got a lot of them in the U.S. and around the world even, and they know the game. They know all the rules. They made the rules. You know, they passed all
the rules.
And so, you know, their kids understand it, you know, because they got the same lawyers and, you know, the same this and that. And so they know it right out of the gate. Most people, you know, they get to our age and it's like, oh, now I'm starting to figure it out. Well, I wasted all this energy, you know, into the system that I really didn't have to do. And I could have done it a better way legally. And I didn't do it because I didn't know. Nobody taught me, you know. Well, and
that's why after 2017, it's like, had I had taken profit, then I would have had to have moved out of the country. Mm-hmm. So then it became, how can I become structured and maybe explain that to people, what I did and how I did these different things. I took advantage of the bear market of 2018 and 2019 and formed the trust in 2019, then donated all my assets to it in order to operate through it. Now I find out that I can run an S-Corp and many other entities underneath it and actually put me in a better tax bracket to be able to run different other things through than just the trust. Because the trust, I get hit with 37% in capital gains versus what a normal an individual would have to pay only 20% in long-term capital gains for more than $450,000. Well, for me, it doesn't matter if I take $100,000 or $1,000,000. Doesn't matter. I still have to pay 37%. And the difference of that, I've heard some people say they don't care. They'll pay 50%, whatever. Bullshit. Okay. The thing is that if I take $1,000,000 in capital gains and I have to pay 37% versus 21% under an S-Corp. Okay, I'm fine with paying the additional 1% as long as I can remain legal and still operate and do it. And the thing is that it's a difference of paying $210,000 versus $370,000. Well, that's a difference of $160,000. That's a nice little fishing camp down in Delacroix, or a nice little condo on the beach somewhere. That's what that is to me. And and for family and friends to come and visit, it's like, why would I want to just give that away to, like I said, to Afghanistan? I don't want to.
Very good, very good. That's a great point, Dave. But I'm going to give you one that Westwood would probably be familiar with. It's a term. This is in Spanish. But there's a saying down here in the South. They go, don't worry about it. Papi paga. And that means, don't worry about it, daddy pays. And he would know he's got through there. Yes, daddy pays. Don't worry, daddy pays. Papi paga. Papi paga. And that's why I'm telling you, we're getting to the point where we're getting taxed to death. Look, you buy a car, and you sold your car. He sold that Digibyte. Westwood bought that Digibyte used. He paid taxes. He bought it from a buyer. The guy already bought it. He paid taxes. How many times have we paid taxes on dollars. This shit?
With after-tax dollars.
At what point, wait, the dollars that you made to buy that Digibyte were fucking taxed. At what point do you go, wait, so if that car is sold 16 more times, guess what? There's taxes paid on that. We're already paying our license. Don't say, well, it's to fix our road. No, that's what the license is for. And now everything became a tollway. We're in a lose-lose situation, and if people don't open up their eyes, you're about to get screwed. When you buy that brand new car, that as soon as you drive it off the lot, it's not a brand new car anymore, and it just evaluated 40%. Dude, you're the guy that walked into the casino. You're the guy that walked into the room, to that poker room, and you don't know who the sucker is. I'm with you, Westwood. I don't care if I buy you.
Think about it. Think about it, though. You know, like you said, after tax dollars, you take those dollars and everything you buy, you get taxed again. And as you say with your example, at some point, that car, I mean, it's way more than the value of the car. It's been paid and paid and paid over and over again. And what do you got to show for it? I mean, the permission to drive it, so you don't get hassled.
And then you got to pay the license plate.
I mean,
you got to pay taxes on that, too.
Sure you do.
And then you got to go in and pay. At what point do you go, that gasoline you put in or diesel you put in that, that's taxed too.
Absolutely.
At what point do you come in and you go, that thing in Guadalajara, like Blind Day says?
Right.
You know what? Things are just done differently over there.
And that's the attraction. That's the attraction of El Salvador to a lot of people right now. They're looking for those places because it's like, what am I doing? I'm not going to win. I'm losing.
You know, what is that guy named Max Kaiser? He ain't a broke bitch. He's got a lot of money. Why is he living there? Why the shit is that? That guy can live here. He's got enough money to spend. You know why?
Didn't want to.
Because he said, what did Elon Musk say to that other guy? He said, fuck you.
Go F yourself.
Go fuck yourself. And then he went down there and he goes, you know what? I don't need to go back. Because anything in the United States, it's cheaper for me to fly it the fuck on a goddamn plane over here so I can enjoy it than it is for me to go and live over there. I could bring the United States to me. I want a car, I can bring that car.
Same thing with, like, say for myself, same thing. So let's say that the trust operates in Louisiana and one other state and owns rental property where the revenue goes through. However, yes, I would have to pay taxes on that. But if I lived in another place, you know, and I did something similar, then I would be able to escape those taxes there, as well as like Article 20, which is for business in Puerto Rico, as well as Article 22 for personal, if I want to do capital gains that way as well. But I run everything through the trust. And, you know, there just comes a point where there's a reason why the money leaves. Ask anyone who's left New York or California or any of these other states.
Illinois. Where,
right. Illinois.
Yep. Illinois.
Yeah. So, you know, I mean, there comes a point where you've taxed us too much. It's taxation without representation. Well, representation you bring are what, Common Core and all of this craziness. I mean, if I had a child today, I'd be in jail. I would. I mean, I would.
It's a different environment, no doubt.
Right. With all of these different, board meetings and whatnot, but, you know, the school board and all of this. Have you heard some of the things that these children read out, want to silence them? But yet this is what they're instructed to read and to report on in school. Right. And it's like, that kind of shit used to be within the household. You know, if little Johnny has got an issue with wearing women's clothes and stuff, that's for the parents to decide, not for the school system. Okay? I mean,
and Westwood, that's where your tax dollars go.
Exactly. And guess what? You can pay off your property. Yeah. You don't pay that property tax bill. I mean, you think you own it, and you don't pay it, and they'll come take it and auction it off. You know, so Javier can come buy it for the taxes. And then he'll own it.
And then on top of it, then now a child can have a sex change without the parents' consent.
Yeah.
What kind of world are we living in?
Well, what's the age of consent?
This is nuts. This is totally nuts.
Yeah, it is. And I think we all realize it. And it's just, okay, now what do we do? I mean, you know, and that's where a lot of people are. Okay, what do we need to do about this without getting into, you know, full-blown, you know, armed conflict, you know. I mean, what needs to be done? But
they're waiting for us to die off.
The politicians don't listen. They don't care. They're bought and paid for. And they sell out. Let's print some more up. Let's just fund it.
You know, well, that's because they're bond. Those politicians are all bonded men. Well, how is their fucking goddamn toast buddy?
Hey, we need more diapers. Okay.
Yeah, whatever.
Yeah, you need to run the air conditioner at 85 degrees. Meanwhile, everyone else is flying around on private jets with AC left at 60.
Remember the highway to nowhere
in
Alaska? We'll just do a highway. Where is it going? To nowhere. China. Doesn't matter.
In a parallel universe somewhere, there is moral justice where we apprehend the elite and make them undergo a sex change.
Pitchforks.
I think a lot of them have. Have you seen Macron's wife, whatever that is?
What's that bald thing that goes on? I don't know where it's from.
Me?
It's in a military outfit. Bald, ugly, high heel, shoot, skirt.
Keep talking. I'm almost there.
Looks like yelling, but bald. It's ugly, ugly, ugly.
Bald yelling.
Yeah, I don't know. What the...
Was that that video of the eclipse?
I don't know.
They had to cut. Oh, no, that was.
I know. Well, that's Javi, a bunch
you had,
of those
you had me at bald, Javi.
Yeah. Looked like fucking steak, and I don't even know what steak looks like.
Bald.
But it's with high heels and like a woman's military suit.
No, I don't wear high heels. No, I don't. Yeah.
But you would look good in high heels if you would look like this person.
No,
and you're wondering if you can make it into our government. Yes, steak. I mean, you can't be our president.
No, I wouldn't be able to on high.
But you don't. You could be a vice president. We've got a person that doesn't qualify.
Well, you could say he was born in Hawaii. You know, just get some documentation. Say you were born in Hawaii.
Look, is that why? Is that why they call it? Is that why they call it vice president because of all the vices?
A lot of vices.
Exactly. And Dave got. Dave knows a guy. They can do the
Dave
the,
knows a guy that can.
Yeah, Dave knows a guy that does version.
Dave knows a guy with high heels. I get it.
He knows he's got high heels, but he knows that he's got a guy. Because everybody we know knows a guy.
Everyone needs a high heel guy in his life.
Exactly. If I find it, I'm gonna send it to you, Steve.
No, keep that for yourself. I don't need it in my algorithm.
I'm sure. I should down to one margarita, but I don't know. It makes me.
Well, we
kind of
went over a little bit too. Yeah. So, I mean, if
what you
want to keep going, we can. If not, we can end it here. However, y'all want to do it.
It's getting worse.
Yeah. We're kind of getting there. I think. So anyway, 136 live viewers. I want to thank y'all for showing up. Hit the subscribe button, share this video, so that way.
Yeah, pretty cool.
Yeah, that way then we can get out here a little more often. Maybe I don't know. Just you know, the numbers are there. We just don't have the subscribers, but the hours are there, and I'd like to see what all of the other videos that I've got out there are earning ad revenue on. From home improvement to, you know, everything in between, and even into crypto and explaining other things for the trust and whatnot, you know, I would really, that's the purpose of like the different giveaways and stuff that I want to do once we hit 1,000 subscribers, you know, and because that was my goal, was to start a channel and learn how to do this. I succeeded through trial and error, and and I wanted to get this going in a bear market for the bull market, a place where other people can just tune in and whatnot. And, you know, I heard someone with the counter of it, it is like, you know, it's just a bunch of guys getting together. And actually, yeah, that's exactly it. Because in this thriving economy, you know, even though I haven't had a drink in over 2 months now, it's not like I'm a drunk or anything, but, you know, I do like to have a good time. But however, you know, think about this in this thriving economy, how many people out there can actually go someplace and enjoy a bar setting and actually have a couple of drinks and kick back and enjoy talking about crypto? And
not,
that's
not only that, Dave, if I can add to that, like how out of touch with society are you that people don't, you know, have their own medicine? I mean, I get it that the age is pretty low and pretty young out there, but it seems like it's very unexperienced by life. I mean, I smoke a joint once a while, you know. Otherwise, I'd probably bore the shit out of all of you. I'd go away into detail
sinner.
With everything. Yeah,
you're a sinner.
And then you drink a little bit of alcohol. Yeah, so what? Fuck it. You know, live
right,
a little.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Why not have a place where we can come together and just have a good time and, you know, and kick it with crypto. So
hey, they're all jealous. They want to be a part of it. They want to hang out in the bar. That's all.
Yeah, I welcome you. Look, if you
and if you want more of this, if you want more of it tomorrow at 4, 5, 6 o'clock, what
time? I don't even know what time tomorrow. Sometime tomorrow.
4, 5, 6, 7, or 8. You get on there, Westwood and Lisa will continue the show.
Yeah, they have
their own version of it.
Yes.
They do a happy hour show every Friday at, it used to be 4 p.m. Central.
We moved it back to like 6 p.m. Central time now because the daylight and all that, you know, it's kind of too early.
And if you haven't had enough then, there's still one spaces after that where we really just tear it all up. So it's just, it's endless.
It's a brutal day. Fridays are brutal for me, I'm telling you.
And then Sunday after I recoup a little bit, then I do a mining suit adventures show where I talk about mining and different algorithms and different equipment and different things that I'm doing. So
fuck it. I'm going to light another one. I'm going to.
Yeah. And you know what? Dub's got a show also. Yep. And Lisa's show today earlier, or was it today with those four guys? It was an interview. I listened to it. Don't ask me now because I don't remember. But it was a. It's a good show. You know what? There are people giving out knowledge. It's up to you to go and do your own research and find out what's good for you, what works for you. See what go to spaces. Ask some of these people. Ask Dave. Don't be afraid to ask. I've asked Dave for the last three, four years.
Everyone out there, if you're listening. To all the 500 subscribers, when you're listening to this, just ask Dave, all of y'all, at the same time, please, continuously, every day, ask him.
Dave, I call him in the morning, I ask him a bunch of questions, call him in the afternoon.
The only dumb question is the one that is not asked, and I've got the final flaw, so by all means.
So call Dave.
I would love to discuss all these different things with you individually or... welcome to the show.
And Dave's been very available. Westwood's always available. You know what? I guarantee if you have an important question and not a stupid one,
I'm the only one not mentioned. It's like, Dave's always available. Clint's always available. You know, me too. You know.
Yeah. Well, he's always smoking something. I don't know what's. No, I'm just joking.
Stay retweeting the shit like a machine gun out there every single fucking day. You know, you can just follow the Twitter and
I didn't see your face, and I was already
out there. You know, kind of fucking silent piece of meat in the corner right there.
Well, actually,
yeah, silent piece of meat. No, actually, Steak goes to Westwood and Lisa's thing every once in a while, and dude, everybody's willing to give you their honest opinion. These motherfuckers will tell you. You ask them, they will tell you what they truly think. And so there's a lot of value. I've done it. I freaking corner everybody I can.
And I would also like to thank Steak for sharing his intel over the last 3 years of 12 hours a day of research into legislation and litigation of what's coming from the EU in MICA to the United States.
And you're watching it happen on a daily basis. It's happening.
Yeah, but he's too busy to ask questions.
I'm going to be honest with you. It's a hell of a call because I was the first one that actually came with that narrative fucking years ago.
Yep.
And so far, I'm still good, even on LCX, even on the WEF, even on Tether, even on Binance. And it's just happening. And for me, it's like every single fucking news article I read, it's like, yep, that's another one. That's another nail in the coffin. So that's why I'm bullish on that narrative, because when I speak to people that do technical analysis, and apparently the thing that I do is called fundamental analysis, who knew? And they look at charts like alien waves and like liquidity of the market and all that sort of shit, and some are really good at it and most are garbage. And the some that are really good at it, they actually have the same interval in the rises and lows with Bitcoin in correlation with the legislation, which is fascinating to me. Because it just means that you're reading what the system is doing. And that strengthens me, that when you see an overlap on those two things, that I'm like, yep, makes sense from a legal point of view and makes sense from a money point of view. I'm in.
Yep.
Yes, we all appreciate it. And I'll tell you this. I know that the Westwood, I'm glad that Westwood put you in his chat after so much time. Should have done it earlier. No, I'm just joking. But people appreciate your knowledge,
you know.
And yeah, there's a lot of practical jokers in there, but we all appreciate the knowledge you have shared.
It's a great crowd. It's a great crowd, Javi.
Yeah, it's good.
I'm just happy that even if it's just a little, when everyone gets a little bit educated on what's happening, over time you'll see patterns too, you know, and the level of the whole group rises. And everyone will be able to help everyone else out.
That's
so
the goal,
you know,
man.
This is just, and you need everyone, because the market is so big, you cannot follow everything by yourself. It's totally impossible.
Yeah, it's
know, and you need everyone to go into nooks and crannies and details, and you see that happening. I think it was Ryan or Theta on Twitter, you know, doing a shout out with our show with the tweet about Jarrett that we mentioned earlier,
mm-hmm.
and. I love that kind of shit. You know, I greatly appreciate it, because at the end of the day, we're here for proof of work UTXO. We're here for decentralization. We're here for surviving the system. We're here also to make money. I mean, we're not shying away from that. Of course we are. I mean, we're also investing in it, but we're also really, you know, enthusiastic about the technology and what it can bring. I don't think it's a nothing burger. I do think it's a step in the right direction to tackle this double spending problem, tackle inflation, you know, tackle Byzantine generals problem. And it does do that at the end of the line, but it's such a long road. You know, it's a decades long road to integrate that completely and get rid of the debt in the market. And yeah, I like it for that. I like the fact that we log everything, that we go through it. I can listen back to old shows about certain topics and be right. Oh, damn, we already said it back then. You know, I like that. And yeah, at the end of the day, it's like a narrative that gets spun up. And then I like it more because it goes against mass media, because they're just bullshitting you. They're giving you the exact opposite of the thing that you're looking for.
Yep.
And they always do that, but you don't know it when you're just born with the mass media. Then that's just your narrative. And those bunch of crazy people online, they're your conspiracy theorist idiots. But, you know, every single time, you just score a home run and you're like, yeah, I was right. Victory dance. But you never see mass media apologizing for the fact how they bullshitted everything to you. You know, every single fucking thing's never been true. Every politician, you know, basically promises you the world and that they'll solve it. The only thing they do is they increase the current status quo. It's the only thing they do. It's just more debt and more war. It's just the machine at work. And once you know that it's a machine at work, you have two choices. You either go against the grain, become a martyr, or maybe surf the same wave and be like, I'm going to smell the roses and lick my own ice cream while being a little bit cynical about it and trying to remain sane. Yeah, I chose the latter.
Right on.
Damn, man. Why did you say all this shit in the beginning?
There you go. Hey, if you're watching
very,
on Twitter,
very well put.
If you're watching on Twitter, because a lot of people were, go to Dave's YouTube channel and subscribe to that, because, you know, a lot of people watch on Twitter, but, you know, you can subscribe to his Twitter account, obviously, you know, hit the notification bell there when he goes live, but go to his YouTube channel and just hit that thumbs up there too and subscribe.
Right on. We are stronger in numbers, and I want to thank all of y'all for showing up. Again, another great show. Y'all go make it a day. Later, y'all.
Some things in life are bad, they can really make you mad. Other things just make you swear and curse. When you're chewing on life's gristle, that grumble, give a whistle. And this'll help things turn out for the best. And always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the light side of life. If life seems jolly rotten, there's something you've forgotten, and that's to laugh and smile and dance and sing. When you're feeling in the dumps, don't be silly chumps, just purse your lips and whistle, that's the thing. Ain't
always look on the bright side of life.
Come on.
Always look on the bright side of life.
For life is quite absurd, and death's the final word. You must always face the curtain with a bow. Forget about your scene, give the audience a grin. Enjoy it, it's your last chance anyhow.
So always look on the bright side of death. Just before you draw your terminal breath.
Life's a piece of shit when you look at it. Life's a laugh and death's a joke, it's true. You'll see it's all a show, keep them laughing as you go. Just remember that the last laugh is on you. And
always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the right side of life.
Come on, wind you up. things out in the sea, you know. Always look on the bright side. I mean, what you got to lose, you know? You come from nothing, you're going back to nothing. What you lost? Always nothing. Look on the bright side of life. Nothing will come from nothing, you know what I say? Always cheer up, you old bugger. Come on, give us a quiz. There you are. See? In the film. Incidentally, this record's available in the foyer. Always look on the bright side. Some of us got to live as well, you know. I said to him, Bernie, I'll never make that money back.